Okay. All right. Everyone, welcome back to the New Carlisle Town Hall meeting scheduled for March 6th, 2017 at 7 p.m. 8:15, we can adjust that, Mr. Collier. So when you are ready, we will do the roll call, sir.
Give me a second. Mayor Lowry?
Here.
Mr. Reynolds?
Here.
Mr. Lindsay?
Here.
Mr. Leidy?
Here.
Mr. Rick Lowry?
Here.
Mr. Lethley?
Here.
Mr. Krabacher?
Here.
All members are still present.
Thanks for respect. All right. I think most of you have been here for the last meeting. We appreciate you guys setting the agenda. I don't know it was exactly the most entertaining. But tonight what we'll do is we'll go through, you guys will get to meet, we'll go down the line of the administration side, let them tell you a little bit about their jobs, what they do, some of the highlights of 2016, and what's been going on in their departments. And then we will also go down the council side, introduce ourselves, talk a little bit, and then we will move on to questions from the public. And then at the very end, we will have originally it was supposed to be the normal council meeting that we just held, but we moved the water rate increase ordinance to the end of this meeting because we assumed that we would have a packed house and we would like you guys all to be here to go over that and hear the votes. So with that being said, I will hand it over to Mr. Randy Bridge, the city manager, and followers.
Well, thank you so much, Mr. Mayor, members of the council, members of the public. I'm going to start with a short introduction. My name is Randy Bridge. I am your city manager. I am responsible for all aspects of city operations. If it happens in the city, it falls underneath my jurisdiction. I did not do this alone. It's a very monumental task if I had to do so. I have great administrators that's right here. How we're going to do it is I'm just going to let them go down the line, briefly introduce themselves and what they do. Then we'll come back to me, and I got about a four-page document here. I'm going to read for you. Packed full of great stuff that happened in 2016. And then each department head will go back and give a little overview of their department as well. So that is that. Are we ready to start?
Yes, sir.
All right. We'll get into me first, and then we'll take it back to you guys.
Yes, sir.
Sounds good?
Yep.
All right. I didn't want to go stand at the podium, but we got a lot of people in the back, so I don't want to have to my back face you, so I'm just going to sit here and do this. And not normally do I read verbatim in my professional career, but there's so much stuff I do not want to miss that I am just going to read off this letter. Thank you.
So we pick you up for sure.
Absolutely. Okay. I would like to extend a thank you to all of you in attendance this evening. It's an honor to be the city manager of this great city that we all love and wish the best for. Nearly 2 years ago, the city council hired me as the next administrative leader of New Carlisle. In those 2 years, we've completely changed the game. And I emphasize we. To all city staff, thanks for your continued support and dedication to myself and the city of New Carlisle. I have never managed a staff as great as this group of dedicated public servants. Through collaboration and discussion, we have propelled this city in the direction it needs to be going. To the city council, it has been a pleasure to work with each of you, either as a group or at the individual level. Moving forward, I wish that we build on the momentum that we have created to better align the city for growth, for future growth and accomplishments. What a great year in the city of New Carlisle in 2016. Our community swimming pool awakened from the ashes to have a successful year full of warm weather, community events, and new faces. I want to extend a sincere thanks to the new management staff who ran the pool very efficiently, especially in labor hours category. Our fire department, under the leadership of Fire Chief Steve Trusty, had an amazing year that saw the fire division respond to over 1,000 EMS calls and over 100 fire-related calls. The department purchased new gear and apparatuses and secured the life-saving Lucas tool. Chief Trusty will go into further details about his department and especially the Lucas tool here very shortly. Our police division, led by Sergeant Underwood, made great strides in the city in 2016 as well, and we're all very proud of them. A concept of community policing was introduced in the city in 2016, and the effects of that are shown. While we have two newer faces behind our patrol vehicles in Deputy Johnson and Deputy Gonzalez, we have two deputies that came to New Carlisle in our darkest hour, right after the passage of the police levy. Deputy Cruz and Deputy Allender have taken the concept of community policing and redefined it. I've received many compliments on each of our deputies, and in this day and age of police relations and the public, these compliments are very, very refreshing. Sergeant Underwood will also give further insight into his department's accomplishments in 2016 here momentarily as well. Our public works department, led by Mr. Kiko, who's our service director, had a great year in 2016 too. The city completed the Edgebrook overlay project with 100% of street levy funds. That is funds that you guys brought in to vote, that 100% went to work for that project this year. Mr. Kiko had a major push on ash tree removal and purchased new equipment to better serve the needs of the residents and business owners of the city. Mr. Kiko will also dive into details a little bit later on. Finance department, led by Ms. Harris, and I want to stress this, I have caps in my speech here, had a phenomenal year. The report submitted for Town Hall describes exactly that. We underspent in 2016, we underspent in 2016 $640,547, or 11% of our approved spending budget. We drastically increased our general fund ending balance from $169,320 at the end of 2015 to over $520,000 at the end of 2016. We have decreased our city debt profile in 2016 by paying off approximately $2.6 million in debt, to include an OPWC loan and multiple OWDA loans for our wastewater treatment plant. We're also currently in the process of working with Ross Sinclair and Associates with some of our general obligation debt to refinance our current bonds with a lower interest rate that will save this city an additional $133,000 over the course of repayment. The department also did more work with less staff. We did not hire the much needed additional office help for our tax and finance operations. Ms. Harris will detail these accomplishments momentarily. To review the entire year 2016 would be a very difficult task, needless to say. So please let me discuss some of the major issues the city was facing last year. The city's health levy was facing a renewal on the November ballot. The levy supports a wide variety of community-related programs, to include but not limited to childhood immunizations, flu clinics, blood pressure clinics, restaurant and grocery store inspections, and plumbing inspections. A renewal of the existing 1 mil for 6 years, passed on November 8, 2016, by a vote of 1,108 for the levy and 1,009 against the levy. The levy passed by just 99 votes, with a total vote count of 2,117 votes cast. We would like to thank those who supported the levy, as it will provide health and related services to our citizens over the next several years. The income tax credit. First off, what is an income tax credit? Please let me explain. If you leave the city of New Carlisle to work and you pay into that taxing authority's taxing structure, your New Carlisle income tax will be credited the amount that you already paid to where you work. Let me break that down for you a little bit further and some numbers for easy math. The New Carlisle income tax rate is 1.5%. Let's say you work in Springfield and their income tax rate is 2.5%. Since you've already paid Springfield's 2.5% and the city gives you credit for paying that, you have nothing left over to pay the city for income tax, because of our 1.5% is a very respectable low income tax rate. For any instance that the city would be able to collect income tax on your behalf, the taxing authority's income tax rate will need to be less than 1.5%. The bottom line is this: a vast majority of our residents leave the city to work, and they will pay taxes where they work and not where they live. In 2016, the city was made aware that a citizen was circulating a petition for the city of New Carlisle to give income tax credit for taxes paid to another taxing jurisdiction. This would have been, and still would be, devastating to the city because we will see an approximate 60% decrease in income tax collections. The tax credit petition of 2016 was denied being placed on the ballot by the Board of Elections due to the petitioner's failure to place the statutory warning language that's required on each page. As with any legal matter, this did cost the city approximately $22,000 in legal department funds to address the petition. Again, the city spent $22,000 last year on the tax credit petition. Recently, the city was made aware of another petition that is currently circulating to place the income tax credit back on the ballot this November. I have requested some preliminary numbers from our tax department that details how much the city will lose with actual 2016 revenues and projected 2017 revenues. The city's estimated revenue for 2017 income tax is $1.6 million. If the tax credit is placed on the ballot and approved, that income tax collection will result in a loss of approximately $984,000, leaving our new projected income tax collection at $659,000. We're working on details that will detail exactly what will happen to the city if the tax credit will pass. More information to come, but needless to say, it will be devastating for the city. Twin Creeks. The infinite basin vacant parcels at Twin Creeks has also been on the city's radar for many years. The Twin Creeks development years ago was then a highlight for the city, but the city was not able to see the future then or now. The new housing development was supposed to bring as many as 700 new homes to the city, complete with a community swimming pool, green space, clubhouse, and other attractive features to help sell the homes in the development. Sadly, the developer passed away before the project was completed, leaving the city with an area that only had a very small number of the projected houses actually built. The infrastructure, to include the underground utilities, bridges, and roads, were already in place and had to be paid for without the taxing of the vacant parcels. To move the project forward, the city and for the city to relieve itself of unproductive and vacant parcels in the land, the city entered into a land reutilization program with Clark County. Under the terms of this program, the city had to take ownership of the parcels. This allowed us to sell the vacant parcels at market rate pricing and also permitted the city to reimburse ourselves for any monies used to maintain or administer those vacant parcels. A blessing for the city was Don Hell Properties, who wanted to purchase all 27 parcels at a bulk dollar amount of $189,000. Immediately, the city was reimbursed approximately the $8,900 that was spent on maintaining and administering the parcels. The remaining $181,000 will be used to reimburse those taxing jurisdictions that were never originally paid. These include, but are not limited to, the Tecumseh Local School District, the city, Clark County's General Fund, MRDD Park District, and the public libraries. Kennedy Trust. The Kennedy Trust lawsuit has followed the city over the past few years, aggressively seeking closure with our law director. In 2016, the city ended the suit. The lawsuit was a direct result of a large parcel of land in Twin Creeks that was assessed back taxes when the development project stalled and the owner and a portion of the settlements for infrastructure were placed on that parcel for payment. The trust, the owner of the land, claimed that that particular parcel was never meant to be part of that Twin Creeks development. The city disagreed. We even had maps to prove that they had originally planned that out to be part of that full development. The remediation process, both parties came to a settlement agreement that was approved by City Council on October 17th. The terms of this agreement will see the city losing that parcel, but gaining $130,000 to use as they see fit. It is crucial that a large portion of this money is applied to the debt the city is currently paying on the infrastructure improvements. The cost of the Kennedy lawsuit in 2016 was approximately $39,000. Tax collection outsource. City Council approved by Ordinance 1643 by a close vote of 4-3 to outsource the city's income tax collections to CCA. This move was suggested by city administration in an effort to reduce our overall payroll costs, increase tax collections, and taking to court those who owe the city income tax. CCA was chosen over similar agency due to one fact. And that one fact is that CCA is able to cross-reference the federal database and compare it against those who do or do not file within the city limits. That is a huge aspect of being able to determine who owes you money and who not. Everybody, most everybody, files federal taxes. Not everybody files local taxes, or are they honest with local taxes. This move is expected to save the city approximately $32,000 yearly while increasing our income tax collections. The waste management contract. The city entered into a new waste management contract in December of 2016. The new contract eliminated the bag system and created a multi-tiered system that our residents can choose from. The bags were eliminated to increase pickup times and to reduce the amount of blowing trash and have all residents in a single or double family home on a trash cart system. The new contract also allows residents to place their yard waste and with their regular trash, which is no additional need to buy yard waste bags from retailers or to separate it out into a different container. Waste management contract has been, we've had some mixed up and down emotions and reviews on it. I think the further we get away from December and people are understanding the new terms of it, we are starting to see a lot more people get the new terms of the new agreement. I will say this, the amount of blowing trash has significantly reduced. So having all trash be mandated to be in a container with a closed lid is helping everyone out. So the question may remain, what exactly playing the city manager for? A colleague of mine told me, if you do not pay for your salary every year, then you are not an effective city manager. It is normally not my style to promote my accomplishments, but I had a few council members ask me to discuss the following points. Playground. In 2016, the city had a wonderful gift that bringing many years of enjoyment to our residents and guests who visit Smith Park. In conjunction with Clark County Combined Health District, Sarah Dolling House, and a Creating Community Healthy grant, the city received a $22,000 playground free of cost, and it's sitting right outside these doors here. This is much needed. This much needed and modern playset is conveniently located directly across from the entrance of Smith Park Shelter House. Police. In 2016, the city also saw significant savings on two aspects of city operations that are imperative: policing and communications. Our contract with the Clark County Sheriff's Office is crucial for the safety and well-being of our residents and those who live and visit. For many years, the former sheriff had charged the city on a top-step basis. What this means is that the city pays the deputies at the highest pay and insurance rate possible, regardless of what they actually paid for insurance or actually how much they actually got paid for what they do. What this really means is that the city was overcharged for what we're actually getting. Upon a discussion with Deputy Allender, who I will not take 100% credit for this, it was one simple question. Deputy Allender, how much did you get paid? With that number known, I was able to work with the math backers to determine that the city was being overcharged. Because of that, a new way to bill the city for police services came out of this discovery, and that we will only be billed for what we use. Every month, I get an invoice from the sheriff's office that breaks down the deputies that we have on contract, their insurance, and other costs associated with that individual deputy. The result, the single question from the city manager, Deputy Allender, saw a police contract savings of $135,000 this year alone. AT&T. We have an agreement with AT&T for some phone service here in the city. I review contracts on a frequent basis, looking for new ways to reduce spending. Upon review of the phone bill, I could not wrap my head around why our monthly bills were $3,500. It was determined that the city was paying an additional $1,545 for a water tower circuit alarm used to monitor the water height at Scarf and Adams Towers. The issue with this is the city stopped using that circuit alarm in 2014. And a switch to a radio system alarm. The city never dropped the circuit charges from the bill until a review of the contract started the overcharging. This will save the city approximately $18,540 a year. So please allow me to turn this over to each of the department heads that have also accomplished amazing goals in 2016. On the agenda, I had our finance director going first, but in the sake of time and public safety, I am going to allow our fire chief, Chief Trusty, to go first. He's got some fantastic things to tell you, but more importantly, he's got some fantastic things to show you. Chief?
Thank you, Randy. First off, I want to show everyone what you've heard us talking about for the past several months, the department wanting to purchase a Lucas tool. This is Assistant Chief Geiselman, who's our Assistant Chief of the all EMS operations, firefighter paramedic Lucas Powell, and firefighter EMT Garth Musgrove. They're going to demonstrate and show you what the Lucas tool does. Lucas tool was developed as an automatic CPR device that does perfect CPR on a patient, whether the patient is stationary or if we're moving them on a cot, moving them up and down the stairs, or whatever we have to do. The cost of the one Lucas tool is a little over $13,000, and then acquiring a contract a year later. But it drastically brings back the ability to get a pulse back on a patient in the field. See now, that's what it's going to look like on a patient. The only difference being that's a half mannequin on a full body patient. The patient's arms are put up on each side of the device and strapped in, and there's a strap that's put behind the patient's neck, which stabilizes the unit on the patient. Now, there's a lot of people to thank for this, for bringing this to the division. First of all, I'd like to thank everybody that's responsible. If I miss anybody, please, I thank you. First off, the church brethren last year started during Lent, taking up a donation every Sunday, special donation for the Lucas tool. They started it off for us last year. Then the Heritage of Flight Committee decided to give us their portion of the 50-50 drawing from the Heritage Flight Festival. That was another big donation to us. And then we sold hot dogs at the Heritage Flight. We sold hot dogs at a car show. Everybody bought hot dogs from us. That helped. And then, Councilman List, I pronounce your last name wrong every time.
It's all right.
He went to the security bank and asked them, told them what we're trying to do, and got them to do a match of $3,500 for any donations over a 90-day period. And he started it off, him and his wife, with a $500 donation. And then New Carlisle Federal, they gave a $500 donation. Then the Rotary Club gave a $500 donation. And then Fab Metals gave a $2,500 donation. Within 3 days, we had enough money to buy the Lucas tool.
Domino's Pizza as well.
Domino's Pizza.
What was the cost again, Chief, just so they know? The total cost again?
The cost of one unit is over $13,000. It's named as Lucas tool, but to us it's the city tool. The division didn't buy this tool. The citizens and business owners of this city bought that tool. Every time we use it, it's like you putting your hand on that patient. Every time we use that tool. Now, We ordered the tool, got it delivered. It was delivered last Monday. Took it out of the box, charged up the batteries, got it all set up, put it on the apparatus at 7 p.m. Monday night. At 10 p.m. Monday night, we had a full arrest. The crews responded to went out as a difficulty breathing, got on the scene, got the patient in full arrest, had the Lucas tool pulled with the help of all the crews who were on scene and Deputy Allender. She's an honorary member of the department. That's it. She belongs to us and the sheriff's department. That's just the way it is. We tease her, call her Narcan, because she's Narcan more people than we have. But we was able to put the Lucas tool on the patient, We got a heart rate rhythm back on scene and was able to transport the patient to the hospital. That's a save for us. The tool was in service less than 3 hours.
Wow.
And was used. And that's, you just don't see that. That's a big deal for us. And this is going to give us the capability of bringing people back on the scene. Instead of having 4 or 5 people swapping out every 2 minutes doing CPR, 3 people can effectively run a code. Because all it takes is putting that device on the patient, getting the tube down for someone to back and a paramedic to administer drugs. And it doesn't interfere with anything else that we're doing to the patient. We can defibrillate the patient, we can shock them, we can give them drugs, we can intubate them. It doesn't interfere with anything. It is truly a life-saving tool, and it's putting another person on the grid. And speaking for the entire division, we thank you. As far as for 2016 with the division, as city manager stated, we responded to over 1,013 EMS calls in the city, 135 calls in Elizabeth Township. We responded to 112 fire-related calls in the city and 17 related calls in Elizabeth Township. If anyone doesn't understand when I say Elizabeth Township, the fire division for New Carlisle is also contracted by the Township of Elizabeth Township for fire personnel. We man their, it is their equipment and their station, but we supply the personnel for it. And it's kind of like our sister station, which that station also has a Lucas tool in it. So we have 2 in the immediate area. Some of our accomplishments this year, we had an air compressor donated to the department. It's a different type of air compressor. It's not like what you see in a shop or anything. This air compressor is used to fill our SCBA bottles, the air that we wear, the packs that we wear on our back. This gives us the capability now to fill our own bottles instead of having to go to another department to get it done. We purchased a LifePak 15 for $25,000, a state-of-the-art LifePak for cardiac arrest, defibrillating patient. We purchased 12 new sets of bunker gear, turnout gear that the firefighters wear. When we first took over, we were in the hole for bunker gear. We didn't have any. I couldn't hire people because I couldn't put bunker gear on their back. It costs approximately $2,200 to outfit one firefighter. So we were able to purchase 12 new sets of gear, which now we stand where we have everyone suited with gear, and we have approximately 4 to 5 sets in the stock. That way we can hire more people or we need to replace a set of gear. Assistant Chief Geiselman started our CPR program again this year, to where she is teaching CPR to groups in the city or individuals that need it at no cost to them. We started our smoke alarm program, where we're putting smoke alarms in the homes for anyone in the city that needs them, no charge, no cost, and our crews will come out and install them. That way we know they're installed properly and in the right places. We hired 10 new personnel for the part-time program, bringing on more paramedics, and we also brought on more people that's locally in the area, either in the city or surrounding, where they can respond easily. We received over $4,000 in fire and EMS grants the past year, in between some EMS reimbursement grants and some fire grants, which helped out tremendously, which also helped pay for the Lucas tool. $3,200 reimbursement grant that we received will help pay for that also. But 2016 was a really good year for us. Our run volume was increased, but we also increased personnel. We increased with equipment. We've increased with training. We've opened up our training. We're now doing more training with other surrounding departments as a combined effort, because we know that any type of fire that we have in the area, all the departments are going to be there. So, other than that, that's basically 2016. Any questions?
Thank you, Chief. Appreciate the report. You guys have done an excellent job this year and last year as well, obviously. Mr. Lindsay,
Chief, since we have the one Lucas tool, could you use another one?
Yes, sir, absolutely.
Could you use it for our second medic that we have been putting it on the road because the first medic has been out, correct?
Well, more than likely, what we would do with the second Lucas tool, we would place it on the battalion vehicle. That way, if medic 52 is out, if they're taking a patient in the hospital or whatever, and we have a second medic call, usually that we have a battalion officer on, that battalion officer can go directly to the scene. One person can set that unit up and have it going while either medic 52A is getting out the door second, or if we have to call for a mutual aid medic.
Thank you.
Just so everyone knows, the Lucas tool, I went on a fire training exercise with Chief Trustee over the summer last year, and they said, hey, Ethan, sit up here and try to do CPR on this fellow, the thing for 2 minutes. I did it, the dummy, for about 2 minutes, and I did it for about, 30 seconds, and I was like, oh my gosh, you're already worn out. And it's constant. You got to keep moving people back from one person who's got to switch because the other person has to rest. I mean, and you have to hear this stupid thing click every time, and I personally would have died if I was doing it. But I definitely think it's super important, and we've talked about it plenty of times, and I think it's something that, Mr. Leffley, thank you so much for doing what you did and everyone else. But it's super important. It's a really neat tool, so I'm happy we finally have it.
Thank you, Chief. Move on down to your side there, Mr. Bridge, whoever you want to hand it to.
All right. We'll go with the Police Administrator, Sergeant Ralph Underwood.
Thank you, sir. Audience, council members, thank you for meeting us tonight. Now, before I get into some of the things that I've been doing, she's been a big part of it. She's done a great job. She is community service. You'll see her on the bicycle more this year. Anytime you have a question or concern, feel free to stop her. And she'll let you know if she has time or not. And that's just good policing. Then we have Bruce Johnson. Bruce, stand up. Bruce is here on his own time. He's new, a couple months, 3 months, November, okay. He's very interested in the city of Newport. He's our daytime deputy, and he's doing a fantastic job. Bruce is on me about getting equipment, which is what we've been through, which brings me to, thank you, Bruce, which brings me to that we are now able to start buying equipment that's needed in the patrol cars. Some of the things that we have been behind on because of our crisis a couple of years ago, we're still trying to get our cars up. We have a new car that Deputy Sheila Cruz has. Hopefully we'll have another one for the hour here in the next few months. And it's essential that we get those cars replaced, because we have one car that Deputy Johnson's in is 15 years old. Now, Howie and his crew have taken it, basically tore it apart, put a new front end in it, whatever, transmission. I would assume, and I'm almost certain that's not the original motor. But if you stop and think about a 15-year-old car, any of the kids in here 15 years old? 15-year-old in here?
Yeah. Have they all left?
What?
We'll give you a live test later. So we are slowly building our equipment back up to what it should be. We've been able to purchase vests for our deputies that are on duty, which is essential. I worry a lot about them up here because they are the end of Hart County. During a shift change, they're by themselves. And there's a lot can happen between here and 120 North Fountain Avenue, which is where the sheriff's office is. I commend them. It's not an easy place to work at times. There's hardships just getting here sometimes. Not everyone lives close. And I'm okay with that because we have quality people up here now. So I'll get into our report some. And I should say this lastly, thank you so much for supporting your police department through your tax money. We are already concerned in the next, 3.5 years, that we may have to come back to you again. But we patrol your area. We are first responders. I guess they call us a necessary evil sometimes. It's no fun for us to take anyone to jail. It wasn't any fun. Well, kind of was for me because I saw her acting when we went out tonight. But no one likes to have a citation. No one wants to go to jail. But you know, to maintain community and keep it safe for us all, that's necessary. And without a police department or without law enforcement, your community will rapidly go downhill. We're in between a couple of very large cities, and we actually had trouble for a nearby city that would like to bring their people in here. And we know they're bringing in drugs, we know they're bringing in crime. So again, thank you. It is much needed. I'm trying to call me all night here. So with that, I'm going to give you some stats. I actually broke down from accounts and stats and like arson, breaking and entering, burglary, and that sort of thing. And it's quite a long list. What I want to tell you is that we took,
thank you, sir.
2015, we took 466 criminal reports. 2016, we took 458 criminal reports, which there was a reduction of just about 1.46%. You know what we've got? That's great.
Thank you.
We also, our total reports for the year in 2015, we had 619. And this year we had 621. So it's pretty close. So total, our deputies up here took 1,079 reports. And a lot of those reports have arrests with them. Now, one of the problems that they're encountering now is, of course, after the election, we switched over to a new reporting system, and it's not easy learning the new computer stuff. But the county, as we've been blessed, they have gave us 4 new laptops and all the software and the IT behind it at no cost to the citizens of Nicaragua. So we're working with Clark County, and they're back to supporting us and deputies up here, and it's not going to do anything to get better. With that, I'll entertain any questions that you might have, and we'll go to the next.
I've got one question, sorry.
Yes, sir.
I noticed on the next two pages, though, in 2015, there's no column for overdoses, you know, in 2000. But in 2016, you do have a column for overdoses of 17. Now, and also the chief could probably chime in on this, and you know, it's close to my heart, you know, about the overdoses, you know. Can you elaborate on that just a little bit?
So we didn't keep track of the overdoses in 2015 because they're not like they were in 2016. Our governor mandated that we administer Narcan, and you know, we have been administering Narcan, believe me, for about last eight months or so. Heroin is a terrible drug, and some of these people that are on heroin know that it's mixed with something bad that could kill them, and they take it anyhow. So addiction is a terrible thing. I've been in prevention most of my career. I probably have people in here that I've taught their kids, the DARE program. There's deputies that I've taught prevention to. And I'm just going to tell you this. I feel one of the reasons we have such an epidemic right now is we do not have the prevention that is necessary. And why? It's simple. You can't prove prevention works, and the state won't give you money for a program you can't prove it works. I knew this was going to happen years ago. I knew that we stopped giving prevention, we were going to be hurt. Well, we're hurt. We have loved ones, everyday people. We have people homeless, and they're all taking heroin now. And people tell you, well, one time might not addict me. One time, you're hooked. And you may have to go to rehab several times. I don't know anyone that's went to rehab one time and is made. You're going a couple times. And that's thousands of dollars a day. And that's the truth. And most of them are a 30-day program. You're looking at a couple thousand dollars a day for a good treatment program. But we've seen a need to start tracking it in 2016. And 17 overdoses for a community this size is alarming. And we're right close to that now.
In the city, we've ran 18 overdoses so far since January 1, and two of those were DOAs.
And we're not by our first summertime plan. So you're going to see an alarming number next year. Yes, sir.
Sergeant, can I throw something in here? I was listening to a news program out of Cincinnati. One of the area TV stations or radio stations figured out a way to start contacting a lot of the heroin dealers in the Cincinnati area. And the question they asked them was, well, when people find out the people who you're selling to overdose, does that hurt your business? What do you think their answer was?
No.
No, it helps their business. More people will call them when they know people overdosed on their stuff. Now, that's just beyond what I can... I don't get it, but...
No brain.
It helps their business.
It's a squirrel brain.
Then they want better stuff.
Good stuff or death?
It's called a squirrel brain.
Mr.
McLaughlin.
Commissioner.
The question I have for you is your funding for Narcan and for the fire department, also for the sheriff's deputies. I take it you're not carrying any hindered bruises.
Yes, we
Narcan,
are.
Narcan, if you arrive first on the scene or whatever. And I'm sure that, Chief, you have it also. Funding for it. Where's the funding coming for Narcan?
Clark County Combined District Health Department. They give us the Narcan. When we run out, there's documentation. Basically, if Rachel would give Narcan tonight, she'd take a report on it. And it's up to grabs whether there's an arrest or not. We're supposed to get next week a final decision on can we arrest and what is necessary to arrest. So you take the report. The report goes to your lieutenant's office, and there's three of us that can pick up Narcan in the health department and replace it. So we have to make a drive into Clark County and drive back. But I wouldn't want them to go one night without Narcan because it might save someone you know, it might save their life. So have another couple questions. Yes, ma'am.
Well, we'll ask, where does it come from? It's in the combined health district. Who is paying for that fund? Are we passing levies for the combined health district and they're using the taxpayers' money to give to you?
It's
going to be paid for by somebody.
Right. Anytime the government gives you something, we're paying for it. But the city of New Carlisle, and correct me if I'm wrong, council members, does not pay into the combined health district.
No. Our tax levy goes to combined health district. County's probably funded through property tax dollars. That's how that works.
Okay. We, the taxpayers, one place or the other, are paid.
Yep. Some place along the line.
Sure, some place
along the line.
Now, the Narcan that's on the medics is paid, falls under the Greater Miami Valley Drug Back Program. The city does not pay for it at all. It comes straight out of the Miami Valley. We use our Narcan. We just take our drug bag to the hospital and swap it out.
And that's what we do in the health department.
You're freezing.
We also are documenting each
of these cases
in hopes that our county prosecutor will say, okay, we go back to the first one here, and we've already had one person up here had three doses. Well, three different times they've had those.
portion of our house just passed the law, they will charge you to hit it with another jam.
Really?
Yes, or they get an additional ticket and have to pay.
So we're already looking at people for the quarter of year.
It's in the paper.
Of course, if you're indigent, what are you gonna get?
Exactly.
You say,
insurance.
I think someplace along the line, someone has to be responsible, and it's got to be the user, so we can find out where you get it.
How much does it cost Narcan?
It does not cost us anything, the department gives it to us, and their cost, I do not know, and they're probably getting it off brand.
Does Narcan provide over the counter from a pharmacy, you're probably paying anywhere from $45 to $65 per dose.
And you can now get it in grocery.
Right. There's a lot of our citizens in the city right now that have Narcan in their home because they know one of their family members is addicted to heroin. Like Sergeant was saying, Rachel carries 2 doses, we carry 4 doses, a max 5. But it's not unusual for us to have to take anywhere from 6 to 8 doses to get a patient back.
Now here's a misconception. If you know someone that is dying because they're on heroin, this is what happens with Narcan. Okay, we administer a dose and we wait a couple minutes, we may have to administer a second dose. We may have to administer a third dose. What's the most you've had up here?
10.
10. Doses.
Yeah.
Okay. We say we're bringing these people back from dead. They're as close to dead as you could ever get. Here's what the problem is. If we don't get them some help immediately, that Narcan wears off and they go right back to where they were at. Well, they have 20 to 30 minutes at the most. So if we give them the Narcan and they don't want to go to the hospital, chances are they're going to die. It wears off. And it doesn't stay that long with
them. So as soon as they're conscious and can tell us person, place, and thing, they can refuse to go to the hospital. We can't force them.
We try to encourage them all we can. I don't think we've ever had anyone not go.
One other quick question. You said there's legislation underway now possibly to be able to charge these people. Is that correct?
Yes, sir.
That may come to fruition here soon. How long will they be able to hold them at that point?
We went through this a couple of weeks ago, and we were going to go back to the first of the year. So, to answer your question.
Well, I was wondering how long if you arrest someone for using that point, and you have to give them Narcan and so forth, you're going to take them to jail. How long would you be able to hold them before they can get out? Because obviously, they get out, they're going to use again.
I can't answer that question right now. I don't know.
Well, and sometimes, too, we can't arrest them right away. We'll find paraphernalia, we'll find relevancy. And although, you know, we know what it is, they're not going to admit what it is. So we actually have to send whatever we collect off for testing. And then it may take 4 to 6 weeks until that comes back saying, yes, this is heroin, or yes, this is, you know, such and such drug. And at that point, we issue warrants for them. So there may be times that we go there and we do find drugs and we are able to charge them, but they still will not be arrested at that time. It'll still be, you know, like I said, 4 to 6 weeks before we can do anything.
It's a vicious circle.
Okay. All right. Thank you, Sergeant Underwood. I appreciate the report. And Mr. Bridge.
Okay, moving on down, our final director, Ms. Harris.
Thank you, Mr. Bridge, Council, Mayor, everyone in the audience. I spent a long night, and the lights can be very quick. I'm reporting our revenues for the year 2016. I do have extra sheets on the table if anybody would like one and would not have one. Revenues that we received for the City of New Carlisle for the year 2016 was $5,900,655.25. Our estimated resources, what we estimated to receive was $5,673,012.15, and we did exceed that by 4%. total expenditures for the year 2016, we spent $5,142,078.10. We were working on an approved budget that we estimated expenditures at $5,782,625.57. We were able to come out with 11% savings across the board. So we were very proud of that. We watched our budget the best that we can, and obviously estimating, you don't know all the expenditures that come in. Highlights for that 11% savings, starting with the general fund. The general fund is my department, the finance department. It is made up of 5 employees. Myself as a finance director. Our tax administrator is Vicki Taylor. We have a finance and tax clerk that is our assistant, and her name is Amy Garman. She joined us in 2015. We have Kathy Marshall in our water billing department. And we have Victoria Portner, and she is mostly the face up front. She's our cashier. She also answers a lot of the Fed's questions. So in our department alone, we had a 13% across the board savings. Most of it came from wages, medical insurance, operating again a staff of 5. We were budgeted for 6. We had 6 in 2014 when I came, and we had 2 that left us in 2015. We picked up 1 new employee. And at the end of 2016, our department actually, the total was the same as back in 2008. So since 2008 and the year 2016, we pretty much, within a couple hundred dollars, had the same expenditures. We're very proud of that. Other income that was a savings, the state highway, which our income comes from state gas tax and vehicle license, had a 66% decrease in our expenditures, mainly due to road salt and in good weather. That helped us a lot. The ambulance operating and fire operating, most of the ambulance operating's income comes from real estate tax, the ambulance billing services that we do, and for contracting with Elizabeth Township. They had a 7% savings, mainly in supplies and some contractual services, along with the fire operating fund, had a 16% savings. Your police levy, your new police levy that came in 2015, we had 29% savings in that fund alone. Most of that was the sheriff contract that the manager worked on, and some fuel and supplies that we budgeted. The water and wastewater funds, those are called enterprise funds. Those are like little mini businesses. Most of them, well, most of all of the income comes from user, and we'll be talking about that later tonight. So the cost of operations for the water department and the sewer department, again, comes from the fees that you use when you get your water bill and the sewer bill. But we did show a 9% savings in the water department on supplies and capital items that they were able to not need that year. Sewer, which is the wastewater plant, had 11% savings. A lot of it was in wages, medical insurance. We had a turn of a new employee and did not need the services. So going back to the general fund is our main fund. It's based, the main income comes from approximately 93% of the taxes. Those taxes are 77% income tax. That is our main source of income. 16% is from real estate. We do get a little bit of local government and some franchise fees that is also in the 16%. Non-tax income that supports the general fund consists of approximately 7%. They're from assessments, permits, shelter, house rental, and a little bit of miscellaneous. So when I started in 2014, we were estimating we had a very bad time here at the city, and we didn't even think we would have more than about an $8,000 ending balance. We did end in the general fund at $52,000. 2015, with the income tax that was passed for the police levy, that started in July, that brought that general fund amount ending balance up to $169,000. Most of the expenditures were now being moved over to the income tax police levy. 2016, we are at $523,980. And that is a good prediction from my experience that we are back on track for a healthy fiscal city. Now, I do not call that a surplus. It's called a reserve, and we'll explain a little bit later. The general fund is your main account that can support other funds, but it is our main account. I don't recommend depleting for other purposes. Anyway, the general fund income tax brought in $1,093,081. Of that, the police income tax levy brought in $533,000. And again, thank you for all the citizens for passing the police income tax levy. It not only helped your general fund, but it helped us. Officer was explaining about the expenditures that they spent in the department. Capital improvements, I'm not going to read through these, but most of the capital improvements, general fund, we've got a new server in our office for our software, the park district got a mower, we got a used truck for the our service or the maintenance mechanic he needed. Edge of a project, and they'll talk about more of this, the street improvement was $207,000 for that project. The fire chief already talked about his life pack and turnout gear that they purchased last year. The police levy got some cruiser and accessories. Water department got some well-needed well pumps and sewer jet for the sewer department. On our debt, we still have facilities, equipment, debt, various purpose bond, and twin crews. That totals $197,656 last year. That is paid out of our general fund. That is still an obligation that has to be taken care of first. Other debt by fund, the street shares the backhoe expense. The street shares that with the water department and the wastewater. They all share and use it. The fire capital has refinanced the finance truck that they had a loan on. That has saved us money, and it should be paid off in about 3.5 years. Police levies, payment for the cruiser, and the water department and the sewer department shares the cost for the new water meters that were put in place in 2014-2015. We have that, and then the new water plant is the biggest debt that they still have to come up with the funds, and that's $217,249. Wastewater, again, shares the water meters with the water department, has the YMCA extension, the wastewater treatment plants, shared backhoe and a sewer debt. Total debt for 2016 was $568,887.48. So in my final notes, our job in the finance department is to keep track of well over $5 million in revenue and expenses. We watch it daily. We're also there as support for any calls or questions that you might have on your water bill or income tax. We have Vicki and Kathy and all of us to help you. I'm very proud of our team, and I want to thank you very much for allowing me to be the director again.
Thank you, Ms. Harris. We appreciate the report. Before we move on, Mr. Bridge, I'm assuming that Mr. Kiko is going to go next. Yeah. Before he goes, should we, because I'm going to assume he's going to get into some of the heavy water. Just no? Mm-hmm. Not yet?
Not yet.
Okay. I just didn't want to. Gotcha.
Ready to go?
Yes, sir.
All right. Ms. Harris, you've done a fantastic job this past year. Pass off to you in a minute. I could not do this without you or Mr. Kiko. So again, I express this to you in person. We have a finance director that is just totally, totally dedicated to this city. And for those of you who don't know, when you come in and you work on the weekend or you go home and you work, a lot of people don't have that determination and dedication in their jobs. People clock out at 5, they go home, they don't think they're up until 7 o'clock in the morning, they get back in here. I've got employees that work and work and work and work without respect to their own personal life. Ms. Harris is one of them. We should all thank her drastically for the amount of work she puts in. It's great. Moving on, we will start with Mr. Howard Kiko.
Thank you, Mr. Bridge. Good evening, Mayor, Council, members of the public. I'm Howard Kiko. I'm the service director, also a certified water treatment operator, so I love water. Not so much in the wastewater side, but I oversee the water treatment department, the wastewater department, and the public works. Public works consists of your street department, cemetery, parks, and just about anything else that we do kind of in-house work, whether it be the substation, repairs, things like that. For just under 2 square miles, we have a lot of infrastructure. We have over 25 miles of roads, so for about every road we got, or an alley, we have a water line or a sewer line running underneath it. So, with that being said, we have about 25 miles of water line and about 25 miles of sewer. With that being said, we are very densely populated, as Mr. Bridges said. So we have taps very close to each other. We have a lot of old infrastructure. The water system came in approximately 1932. And the sewer system about 1938, give or take those dates. With the water, we have a plant about 1.5 million gallons a day. We only pump approximately 500,000 gallons a day. So the plant is capable of a lot more, and that was based on, as we had talked about, in 2006, the new water plant came online for the development of Twin Creeks, the growth of New Carlisle. We had gotten some OPWC funding, 50% grant, where private citizens paid for other 50% to do sewer and water line extensions to get businesses to come in to some of the farm fields north of town and some of the areas south of town. So a lot of private citizens have given their money to, and then we get the other half to get business. Well, to date, for what we have a plant that produces, we do not have that. So we have a very large water plant loan for something that we don't have enough, we just don't pump enough water. That is on for another 10 years. So it will be paid off in 2026. So I have that loan, and I have to deal with that loan. I come into this job in 2007, so it was there. There's nothing, you know, like where we now, any of my projects that I bring in, I get very little bells and whistles. I like some manual controls, and we just try to save as much as we can with the things that we get. Because a lot of, to be honest with you, engineers will really fluff up some of the jobs that they propose for you. For 2016, we had the Edgebrook Overlay Project that Mr. Bridges spoke about. That was 100% street levy funds. Total cost for that actual construction was $187,980. Bids come in at $176,000, I think. And so I only had approximately, I think 1,100 foot of curb and gutter due. I bumped that up to actually use all the money that I put into it to get more curb and gutter replaced. That was over 500 cubic yards of asphalt overlay and 1,175 linear feet of curb and gutter that was replaced plus. It took us almost 2 years to save to get just an overlay project. It averages $200 per foot to do a road reconstruction, and in this case, I didn't do my math on this one in particular, but $187,000 to do 3,000 foot of just an overlay and some curb and gutter. Asphalt road work is not cheap. It's not getting any cheaper. So we're doing our best to work with other entities and get some pricing. Ours isn't bad when we bid, but we're going to try and get that better. We had purchased a 1998 VACCON combination vac and sewer truck. It replaced a 1967 sewer jet truck that we had that could not clean the lines. And we didn't really realize it until we had demoed this truck and all the dirt, the soils, and everything that we blew out of these sewer lines, we were just piling them up. You could take the piles out of each manhole with a wheelbarrow. So the sewer department, right now with 4 people, we haven't really touched our infrastructure out in the distribution system. We have a lot of work to do with having an older truck, and now we got a new truck to try and go clean these mains out. So, also, it is used for hydro excavating. So, in some places where we can't get that backhoe in, we're able to hydro excavate with a suction tube and high pressure water to only maybe make a hole half the size or a quarter the size and not have as many pieces of equipment. We utilize that when we can, and that really speeds the process up. In the parks and in the right of ways, ash tree removal. With the disease that hit our ash trees, it become very expensive to remove the trees. We've had to hire some private contractors to bring trees down. An average tree that we have taken down is about $3,000 a piece on some of the big ones. We do in-house work, but we do have an old bucket truck that will go up to about 40 foot in height or maybe a little higher to get those down to save some money. But with that being said, we did have a couple tree companies that came into our parks and donated their time. We have recognized them in the past via council memos and stuff for those two companies that come in and donated their time, but we have a lot more to go. With this mild winter that we had, we did get a lot of trees done that I planned on doing in the spring. So in the spring, we're going to some of the Northwoods section with the backhoe truck, and we're going to clean out some of those dry wells. People who live in that area have had to live with dry wells that obviously they're outdated. As I get to those streets, those dry wells do get replaced with completely new technology. It's just a 6-foot diameter dry well instead of a 3-foot. But we're going to go out and clean all those out, so at least it's getting the water down in the drains and not staying on the roads and causing more damage. Road de-icing salt. Last two winters have been fairly mild and have really saved the city on salt usage. So far this year, we've only used 60 tons. We bid 300 tons out a year. There have been times that we've used 300 plus, but we're still using the batch from last year that I had delivered just before the season ends. So we're kind of up in the air on if we're going to order a little bit more this year before we go into next year or whatever. But those go back out for bid this summer. Before I move on to a little bit of what we got coming up, wastewater, we do have a major upgrade. A headworks part of the plant is in desperate need of some repair. We have approximately $150,000 going towards a bar screen, which cleans, basically it's your first line of defense to get all the biggest material out of your wastewater before it hits any pump. And with that, I have one little public service announcement, and it's about the sewer flushable wipes. Okay, there's flyers back there. You always see those wipes for your face, wipe, baby wipes, all those blue towels, mechanics towels. We find those in the sewer all day long. That 10-cent rag will can crush $10,000 pump in a heartbeat. Because what it does is we get a few of them making it through the bar screen, and it will get into a cavity and it just starts heating it up and it will burn it up. So the big thing is please throw those in the trash. I mean, that's anything. Feminine products, the flyer describes all kinds of things that could really be better in the trash than be flushed down. Now we do find action figures, coat hangers, we get that stuff, but I think those are kids. But if we could help pass that on and try and get those out of our sewer system, that would really help. 2017 Prentice Drive reconstruction project coming up. That is a $93,000 coming out of our street levy and approximately $290,000 from a community development block critical infrastructure grant. And those are basically federal tax dollars that myself and the county planning, Ethan Harris, had applied for. Last year was the first year of the program, and that went to, typically it goes to the Appalachia area where there is no plumbing whatsoever in homes. They need basically some kind of infrastructure. We actually got $289,000 out of $350,000 that they had up for this year. So that will be finishing Prentice from Kennison to Brookfield. And then next year I'll be applying again to try and get the most grant. They'll use some of our street levy funds to just match, because they don't do all that for nothing. You gotta have a little bit of matching funds. We will be doing some more street work with our street levy funds this year. I have approximately $200,000 to do similar work like Edgebrook. A lot of these streets do not have a good base underneath them. Overlays work where you got a good base and it will last. I won't overlay a street that just is so alligatored up that it'll be gone in another year or two. So I'm working with Clark County. They do a countywide rehabilitation project. We're going to add ours in there, so hopefully we can get some better pricing with that. And as Mr. Bridge said way earlier in this, municipal parking lot upgrade, we definitely plan on doing the seal coating and markings and things like that. And that it, we're looking at that will probably be one way in and one way out, so you don't have cars backing into other cars and too tight. So it'll hopefully leave some congestion and a lot of good traffic flow. And with that, we will hopefully be doing a better job with Parks and Cemetery. This is the last thing. We have a ton of grass to mow for only the size of town we are. We have Smith Park here. We have Brubaker Park, which a lot of people don't know, borders the bike trail in Hamilton, and, not Hamilton, but Zimmerman. We have Grubaker Park, we have Willowick Park, we have Carlisle Park, we have Hensley Park. We got grass, and then we have the acreage of the cemetery. And with the cemetery, if you look at it from an aerial view, the stones are hodgepodge, except for the new areas that we lay out now. Those areas are straight, lined up. We can take our zero-turn mowers. We can move back and forth, no problem. But the rest of it, it's we got a commercial mower that's a special size that when we hire people, like seasonals, they come out, they work about a week or two, and then they're done. They just can't stand being out there weed-eating all the stones, mowing all the stones. So hopefully we can get enough help this year to keep the cemetery looking nice. You know, that definitely is a goal because of all the buried loved ones we have. But my goal has been for a long time is to maintain what we have. We do not plan on extending any utilities. There is some, you know, things that may be in the works, but it's really, I can apply to OPWC. I can get 50% grant to cover almost any utility project, but the city does not have the funds to cover that other 50% because there's no benefit to it. I mean, if there was a brewery sitting over there and I needed to get them 500 feet of line, I'd probably do that because they'd be using water, they don't need any services, and they'd be definitely paying for it. With that being said, we're just trying to maintain what we have. That's all I got.
Mr. Kitcher, could you also touch on real quick just the section of road in front of Waterville?
Oh, yes. The Waterville area has been troublesome. All the Main Street has a concrete base underneath it. We keep patching it. We've done a few cutouts, but this year we're going to cut out the base using state highway funds. So this won't use any of the street levy funds or street funds. Come out of state highway, we will cut some of that area out way bigger. Hopefully put some large rock underneath for drainage and get that completely rebuilt this year. Because I don't know the next time that ODOT will come through and repave. I'm guessing about 5 years. But we have to pay 20% of an urban repaving project. And if any base needs redone, that is 100% on the city for them to redo. So, but yes, that is going to be done this spring. Some major work down there.
Thank you. All right. Thank you, sir.
I think that is all for the administrative list. Again, I just want to say thank you to all the staff. We got some few staff members in the audience. I know Mr. Pearson from the fire department was over here earlier, whether he's still here or not. But those of you who dedicate so much to the city, I appreciate it. I'm sure the council members appreciate it. I definitely know the citizens appreciate it. So let's keep up the good work. Let's not get sidetracked by what social media is saying. Again, I've told you guys 50 million times before. Let them say what they want to say. And this is just pertaining to social media. Our numbers, our work ethic does not lie, and that will always come here at the end. So thank you so much if you do work for the city. And if you don't work for the city but live here, thank you. We thoroughly enjoy doing what we do. I've got thousands of dollars pumped into graduate degrees to do this for a living. I have a passion for it. Everyone here has a passion for it, or we would not be sitting here doing it. So moving forward, we're going to move forward in the most positive, efficient manner possible. So basically, either walk with us, lead, follow, or get out of the way where that savings is going, because we are going full steam, full ahead with this council to get the city where it's supposed to be. So thank you so much for coming tonight.
Thank you, sir. All right, now we'll introduce everyone on council and introduce ourselves and say a few words. I'll start off. I'm the mayor of New Carlisle. My name is Mike Fowery. I've been on city council since 2011, and I've lived in the city since I was born. You know, when I started hitting my 20s, I really started getting interested in these walk on to council meetings. I got on the planning board, the human rights board, and then decided to take a run at council. You know, my family, all my immediate family's here, my kids, my mom, my dad, brothers, sisters. And, you know, the town, I really do think, you see a lot of negativity on social media. New Carlisle's not perfect by any means, and no town is, and no community is, and none of us are perfect. You know, we all have our flaws, but I think for what New Carlisle has, we are doing really good. I mean, you know, I see people saying left and right that how much the city is wasting money and throwing things away. Well, I mean, you can't even say that after he just said he saved over $500,000 last year. I mean, that just stops at point blank. You know, that general fund said right around $500,000. That's a good start, but it needs to get up higher. You know, I think, you know, smaller communities than us have a $4 or $5 million general fund there for things that they may need, emergencies that may pop up. But, you know, with him and his staff cutting, you know, $500,000 out of the general fund, Mr. Reynolds and Mr. Lindsay and some of their friends and family worked hard on some of the parks over the summer, saving the city money there. The pool went from losing $40,000 a year to only losing $1,800 this year. So, I mean, everything is saving money. We're working as hard as we can. And I really am proud to be a part of this town. I mean, like I said, we're not perfect, but I think we're all taking the right steps to get to where it needs to be. So I just want to thank everyone on council and the administration and the citizens for, you know, all of us being a part of this. So I will hand it over to you, Mr. Krabacher.
Well, I'm John Krabacher. I'm the vice mayor. And I raised six boys here in town. And that's why I talk about overdoses, because a lot of them are the young people. But if you look at the statistics, really, some of them are a little bit older than that. That they've come, you know, they come into 20s, 30s, 40s, and 50s. So that, you know, I became involved with FYI, Family, you know, Youth Initiative up there. You know, on Wednesdays, every other Wednesday, if you want a free breakfast, come on up about 7:30, and Carol Bellhorn will fix you a free breakfast.
Yeah.
So we've been talking a lot about overdoses and talked about the task force and the drugs, you know, and how can we get into the schools and the mentorship program. It's kind of a brainstorming time at that particular time. So that's really close to me. I was born and raised in Dayton, Ohio. The place that I was born at right now is in the drug area. It's in the Five Oaks area. If you go in there, it's like a prison. It's dark. It's very, very dark. I like New Carlisle. I love New Carlisle. When I go to foreign countries, people ask me, you know, where are you from? I said, from New Carlisle, Ohio, and I'm proud of that. And he said, where is that? And I said, well, technically it's a rural area, you know, 10 miles from anywhere. You know, but I am proud, you know, of it. I have seen what it's like to have laws and not enforce them. I have seen areas where traffic laws are not enforced. I have seen laws, you know, where you're not supposed to have cows in the city, but they're there anyway, or goats or chickens or whatever. I have seen those areas. And, you know, and I have talked to a lot of those people, you know, and so I've gone on a lot of mission trips. I do that not for self-serving. I do, you know, I went on a mission trip, you know, Randy knows a little bit about, down to Savannah. And so I called Randy and I said, hey, I found something down here you might be interested in, you know. And I wrote down some notes and I brought it back to him. He said, oh, it's a good idea, but we can't work it in a small city. I don't go there for self-serving. I don't go to countries, you know, like I do, self-serving. I go there to see what it's like. And I live with the people to see what it's like. So I bring that back, and I might not say a whole lot up here, you know, and I try to go on social media and help, but sometimes, you know, that doesn't work out either. You know, but my thing is that I love New Carlisle. I want to see it prosper. Do we need Bell Manor? I think we do need Bell Manor, you know, if we do it the right way. And I think we are. You know, we get a little bit ahead of ourselves when we said, you know, we said we don't do our due diligence. I think we're just a little bit ahead of ourselves. We're trying to. You know, give us a chance. So I was here. When we got Madison School, I was here with the plans, was all laid out, and people, maybe two, maybe three people came, you know, looked at the plans, and they said, and many people said we did not know, you know. I think Rick was here at the same time. He was here?
Madison Street came before both of us, huh?
Yeah, but the plans and stuff.
Oh, yeah, to renovate it, yes, to renovate it. Okay, I'm sorry.
Yeah. So I think, you know, we're heading in the right direction. You know, I think Randy is trying to do a good job. And I think, I believe the city is, you know, in the right direction. You know, I think we're in the right direction. But, you know, give us a chance. The whole thing is just give us a chance.
Thank you, sir. Mr. Lowry.
I can't believe two people spoke and they took everything I wanted to say.
Oh, I'm sorry.
So, do what I can. I can only, you know, talk about what Michael and John talked about. I wouldn't live anyplace else. When I first moved to New Carlisle in 1967, I said, I can't wait to get out of here and move back home when I retire. Well, that's never going to happen. I said, you know, when I die, I want to go back to Eldersville, Pennsylvania, and be buried there. Right here. Pardon? Eldersville, Pennsylvania. Yeah, if you sneeze, you'll miss it. And I look back there a lot, and that's what I wanted to get to. When I grew up there, and my wife, she was born and raised on a farm, and I was worked on farms, two filling stations, two grocery stores, several houses, and there's nothing there now. There's no business whatsoever in this little town. And that's why I like New Carolina. It just keeps on going and going and getting better and better. This town is so much better than it was when I came here in 1967. It's absolutely unbelievable. Just so much better. And you know, social media, I don't know what to think about social media. I don't know where these people get ideas. It was on there last night that council members were sticking money in their pocket. These people were sticking money in their pocket, you know, overpaid and all this and that. It's, I gotta tell you, it's absolutely not true. Everyone here looks to do what they can for this town to make it better. You know, if I think Randy's spending $20 too much somewhere, I'm going to mention it to him and talk to him about it, okay? And last but not least, thank you for your service, sir. Veterans come real high on my list. Police come real high on my list. Fire department comes real high on my list. I'm a veteran. I'm more fortunate than you because I served in peacetime. There was no war in Germany when I was there. You're a Vietnam vet. Thank you. But there's a group of people we hear about Blue Lives Matter, first responders. They're great. Can't do without. Group of people we never hear about. Never hear about. And I got to tell you, New Carlisle wouldn't enlist, would not exist. Dayton, no city. The United States would exist, the United States would not exist for the poor guy and girl that goes to work every day and on Friday get their check and open up and see how much we took, the city took, and the governor took. Okay? The working man runs this city and this country, and I want to thank them all. You guys make this city go. I am not stealing your money. I don't know anybody up here stealing your money, stealing it. We're doing what we can, and that's all we can do. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. We'll hand it over to Mr. Jim Lethley. He's one of the newer council members on city council, sir.
I am. I've only been here since December, so I don't know a whole lot. But I do know enough to say thank you to Mr. Bridge, Ms. Harris, Mr. Kitko. Tremendous job for 2016. And I got on council. I'm getting ready to retire later in this year. And I want to keep involved in the community. And I really look forward to serving the citizens of New Carlisle. And I really don't have a lot to say other than very proud of what the administration has done so far. And can't be more proud of where I work for what they did to step up to help with make the purchase of the Lucas tool. So. I really don't have anything else to say other than I look forward to working with all the rest of the members of council.
Thank you, sir. Appreciate that. And moving on to Councilman Bill Lindsay. Sir, how are you? I'm just going by the list.
That's good. That's what I was looking at.
My name's William Lindsay. I've only been in town, I think I'm working on almost 9.5 years now. I moved here from the township in Bethel Township in Miami County. My first council meeting that I came to was in 2015, February. I forget the exact date. Nobody up here, nobody over there, probably nobody out here even knew who I was until that first council meeting. And I read the New Carlisle News that the city was going to have $250 left in their general fund. I can't even begin to tell you what I said in my office. And my wife comes in and says, "Who are you talking to and who are you mad at?" Well, I explained it to her, who I was talking to and who I was mad at, and I came to this council meeting. During 2015, things evolved. I got madder. Somebody said, "Well, instead of getting mad, why don't you do something about it? Why don't you run for office?" I said, "I don't really want to do that." But here I am, sitting up here. I did do that. I did it to try to make a difference in this town. Like I said, I've only been here about 9.5, maybe 10 years now. Before I got here, I was in Vandalia. I am a retired firefighter. Years ago, in my 20s, I carried a badge in Dayton. I decided that was a hazard to my health, was not paying what I felt police officers should make. So I left there and went to work at General Motors, found out I was working with a bunch of cons. Needless to say, I never told anybody I used to carry a badge. It's only been probably the last 10 years that I've even mentioned it, that I did that. I still run across people that I had to deal with back in the day. Of course, they're a lot older. They don't recognize me. I have less hair now than I did then. I think everybody up here truly has the best interest of this city in mind. We do what we can with what we have. Would I like to do more? Absolutely. Am I constantly telling our city manager we need to cut this budget? Absolutely. He'll testify at least 3-4 times in our conversation. I'll tell him we need to cut the budget. We need to be more conservative in our spending. He tells me if we got any more conservative, we might as well shut the books and close the town. But it isn't quite that bad. At least I hope it isn't. We did have a surplus from last year, a little over $500,000. I attribute that to him for his spending habits that he has. And I hope that when time comes, that the citizens will keep attending these meetings and give us input. Like Mr. Rick Lowry said earlier, we work for you. We don't work for ourselves. We don't work for the people over there. You all elected us to do a job. We can't do that job without your input. Thank you very much. Thank you all for coming. Sir, thank you for your service.
Thank you, Mr. Lindsay. Moving on to Councilman Ethan Reynolds.
Hello. Sorry. Hello, I'm Ethan Reynolds. I am serving in my second term city council. I was first elected in 2011. There's only two of us left in that class, Mike and myself. Yeah, I know, right? It's hard to believe. I got elected at 20 years old. I started running when I was 19. We had come a long way since then. I always mention things about draining the swamp and how fiscally insolvent we were. I mean, we had, by the end of 2014, going into it, we had projected $140, and that was it in the general fund. Then we projected we were going to go almost into fiscal watch if we would continue. We had a city manager who didn't pay bills. That's why we ended up having to double up on our payments on the Twin Creeks properties. That was the problem. So we moved in the positive direction. We moved the needle from here to about here. We can keep going. I think we have done a lot in the city. I think you've seen new police cruisers. You've seen additional police. The pool continues to be open and surprised even my expectations of what would have ever happened with the pool. I think everyone has echoed it here. We all care about New Carlisle. Some people believe that their vision might be the better way. Some people believe their vision might not be the better way. But we still, at the end of the day, all love this town and we have to work together. We're allowed to disagree, we're allowed to argue and debate and get into some heated discussion, but at the end of the day, we all care about New Carlisle, whether it be anyone out here, anyone up here, or anyone out there. We all have different views, That's one of the greatest things living in the republic we live. But at the end of the day, it's up to you, the voters, to decide who sits up here. And I continue to thank you guys for giving me a second term. And I will continue to try to be the most conservative voice I can be on council for the next 3 years. So, thank you.
Thank you, sir. And moving on to the final councilman, newer individual, Mr. Aaron Leidy.
Good evening, everyone. I'm Aaron Leidy. As he said, just want to thank everyone for being here. I wish it was a fuller house all the time. Like a lot of people, I got a lot of my information from Facebook, and I couldn't help but think to myself, man, I should probably get a little more involved in what's going on. And I started coming to the city council meetings and really started to educate myself. And it turns out that we really aren't in that bad of shape. And when I got put on council, I sat down for my first budget meeting. And then I learned that the team that we have, you know, cut spending by $640,000. Just wow. And just a little bit about myself. I have three boys, all three and under. I'm married. I live right across the street there. And I also rent a house in town. And it's important for me to see this town do well. When I had a business here, I really wanted to make it thrive. And I wanted to be a part of something great. And I had to shut the doors. And I still kind of felt like I had this unfinished business here in town. And that's why I'm here. I want to try to make it better. And as Mr. Lowry said, man, it is so true. Like, I value everybody's opinion. And that's why it's so important for everybody to get involved. And just not involved in city council meetings, but involved in the community in different ways. You know, for people who are hurting in town, public safety is everybody's job. If you see somebody struggling financially, if you see somebody struggling, you know, like in an abusive relationship, speak up. Go do something about it. There's churches in New Carlisle. There's that reach out to help people in need. We have Bethel Churches United right across from the Methodist Church. You can go in, no questions asked, and you can bring home food and toiletries for nothing. And unfortunately, it's one of New Carlisle's like best kept secrets. So spread the word, stay involved, and man, I hope to see all these faces back next time.
Thank you, Mr. Leidy. And we almost skipped over somebody, the clerk of council, Mr. Gene Collier.
I'll be real quick because we've been here 3 hours right. And 20 minutes. And I'm concerned that I'm going to run out of tape because we've never used this much tape. And plus, I have to do the minutes. So.
You better learn how to write shorthand.
Yeah.
Speed
it up. Yeah. Well, you can't speed it up.
No, I'm talking about you.
Oh, I'm going to real quick. Yeah, obviously, I'm the clerk of council. I am appointed and reselected by this council every 2 years. I'm now going on 4 years. I would and I obviously do the minutes for the meeting, and I've estimated probably in 3.5 years that I've probably done over 600 pages of minutes. Tonight's minutes will probably be 15, 20 pages before I'm done. I keep track of a lot of the council business. One of the things that was mentioned tonight, we've received an intention to petition, and that's a process that once those petitions come to the city, they come to me. Then I make various trips to the Clark County Board of Elections. That whole process begins. I assist Randy's, Mr. Bridge, a lot of times with the agenda as best as I can. I'm only part-time. I'm not here. I don't actually sit in the city building on a daily basis, so I basically keep track of the rules of council. I give council advice on when I think something's not being procedurally is not right. I will remind them and tell them that they need to change it or back off or go in a different direction. And I'm going to highly recommend, since we've still got a very critical issue to talk about tonight, that we get rolling.
Thank you, sir.
I'm usually in bed night out because I drive a school bus. I'm in bed already by an hour. So let's do this.
All right, well, let's.
Well, before we go any further, we told you that a representative from utility right. Service would be in attendance. It's not on the agenda. His name is Darryl Bowling.
Okay.
So I'd like to invite him to go to the podium. 5 minutes or less, sir, if you don't mind.
And you can, we can
go with some questions, everybody.
Thank you, sir, for hanging in there so long.
Yeah. Wow. Such a true thing. Thank you so
thank
much.
You. Thank you, Council. Again, my name is Daryl Bullen. I work for Utility Service Group, and Utility Service Group maintains assets around the United States, primarily in the water industry. With that being said, a lot of things that we do are water tank related. So that's kind of our specialty, if you will. We maintain tanks. We maintain tanks all around the United States, state of Ohio. We maintain tanks for City of Vandalia, City of Troy, Piqua, Covington, Greenville, Urbana, just on and on and on. We maintain those tanks underneath the Ohio Revised Code, which is a tank asset management model program. And basically, that started around 2012. The challenge was with aging infrastructure, especially in the water industry and the wastewater industry, how do you maintain those assets? A lot of times what was being found from AWWA, which is the American Water Works Association, is in a run-to-failure kind of a model. And the run-to-failure model ends up being one of the most expensive methods out there. So they continue. If you ever go to an AWWA meeting, they're always talking about preventative maintenance and just basically maintaining those assets for the long haul. So in 2012, the Ohio Revised Code then started the Tank Asset Management Program. So what it did is it allowed utilities to find ways of basically paying to maintain the asset without running to failure. So you can stay compliant with EPA, AWWA, and all the other agencies out there. It allowed you to spread the cost for all the upfront renovations that was out there. It also created a method that a lot of times working on a steel structure, take your Adams Street tank or any other large tank up there, very difficult sometimes to work on those tanks with those kind of conditions, so there's some workmanship quality issues that were out there as well. So what was happening is people were paying money to have their tanks maintained, worked on, and then they had some sort of short-term failure after a couple years, after they came with the money to get it paid for and renovated the first time, and then had some sort of premature failure. So with not much funding out there in this industry or in the area for funding tanks, with challenges with workmanship, then the Ohio Revised Code has been in place in 2012, an asset management model, which basically shifted the risk from all the work over to companies like ourselves. So if there's any kind of failures, it's our challenge, our fault, not your fault. It allows us to take all the upfront renovations and spread that cost out over a period of year, several years. The Ohio Revised Code says a minimum of 3 years. And then it also puts the asset on a longer-term maintenance model so that it does not, you know, run to failure in the future and you're constantly maintaining it. AWWA says that a steel tank can last indefinitely, but it's maintained. Waiting around to maintain it, it doesn't make it any cheaper, right? So what they're trying to do is find ways to continue to have help and aid you in the process of maintaining your assets in essence. So what we did back in October was Mr. Kitko asked us to come in and take a look at both tanks. We came in roughly the first part of October and evaluated both of the tanks. And we do that by looking at basically the coating systems of tanks, interior and exterior. We look at the tank from a structural condition. We look at it from a sanitary condition based on what EPA and AWWA be looking at. The OSHA, the safety condition as well, and just trying to figure out how to maintain that asset for the long haul. So with that, what we find is usually the exterior coating system becomes the biggest challenge. Coating systems tend to last, you know, 15, 12, 13, 14, 15 years, whatever those are, based on what the coating systems are. And then AWWA says, hey, these things should be repainted on a periodic basis. If you let an exterior coating system run to failure, it starts to chalk, you start to lose the UV factor of the polyurethane that's on the exterior, you get down to the next level of an epoxy coating that doesn't like UV, and then it starts to crack, and then you can no longer overcoat what's there. You're forced then to put the containment curtain over the tank, blast it all down to bare steel, and then start the whole process over. So part of the asset management program is to help maintain and make sure the tank gets maintained before it runs to that failure. On the Scarf Row tank, based on
all the adhesion tests, cohesion tests we've done, paint coat samplings that are out there, you're kind of on the back end of that. You're at that point. If you wait much longer, you're going to move from an overcoat situation where you can now to a point to where it's going to have to be blasted off. Also, part of our process is we check the coating system to figure out what the current coatings are. So if we are going to overcoat it, we're going to be using compatible coating systems with that. And the other thing we check for are heavy metals. So we're looking for lead, chromium, and those kind of things as well. We talked about some hazardous waste things tonight, EPA, and that becomes one of those. So if you have to blast that tank with the situation you have on that one, it does have lead on it, then that almost becomes an EPA hazmat challenge, which makes it more costly as well. So the point you have to blast it, you're probably looking at another couple $100,000 to take care of that situation because of that. You're not there today, right? So our analysis we went through says it can still be overcoated today. Coatings are thin, you have a lot of epoxy showing on the roof of the tank. You see a lot of primer there, so you're losing that so-called overcoat window. So part of our recommendation back to Mr. Kitko is to go ahead and get that tank overcoated soon. We can't sit here today and tell you when that will fail. We're telling you it's the end. And what makes it fail is UV, so hot summers makes that continue to fail and dry. And then obviously freeze-thaw cycles aren't good for it as well. We also did an interior inspection of the tank. The coatings there can probably last another 4 years or so. So on the interior, you still have a little bit of time. There was also some other repairs that need to be done. The safety cable climb on there for some safety issues. So there's a handful of miscellaneous repairs that also need to be done with the tank. But the biggest challenge would be the exterior. If you drive by and take a look at it, you can visually see that it's pretty well expired, if you will, and it's at the end of its useful life. And by waiting only costs more money at this point. And we gave a lot of our findings over to Mr. Kitko as well. So that's in general what we've done. And again, we've painted over 50,000 tanks in our lifetime. So we know what we're doing, we've seen it. And can we tell you the exact date that something's gonna fail? We can't, but we just know that you're on the back end of that curve. And it's needing to have something done to it. Is that my 5 minutes? Is that close?
Well, it's not for me.
You keep it. No. All right, thank you, sir. How do you want to move forward with this? Do you want to allow them to ask questions?
Or? That's up to you and your citizens. Yeah. I mean, how are you going
to
handle it?
Do you want us to do our questions first to him, or do you want to let them ask our questions?
I think they should ask their questions.
We'll let the citizens go ahead and ask their questions if they have, what questions they may have, and then we'll move it back up to us. So anybody that has questions regarding water, now's your time. Just need your name and address, sir.
My name is Darrell Alba. I live at 309 North Adams Street. I've resided in New Carlisle since about 1954, and I believe Mr. Lighty's grandmother was my first third grade school teacher here. My question is, how much is this coating going to cost us on this tank? And number two, have you investigated other sources of financing this project? Yeah, this project. Thank you. And if so, what would those sources be? As an alternative to raising our water rates. I'm 70 years old. I retired 2 years ago. I'm on a fixed income. You keep raising taxes, and I won't be able to afford to live in this town much longer. And I've been here since 1953. Now, I don't want to move out of this town, okay? But as a fixed income retiree, I need you guys to look at this thing rather deeply and come up with alternatives and suggest those alternatives before you vote on this tonight. I think if you vote on this tonight, you're doing a big disservice to the citizens of New Carlisle. We have not, this is the first opportunity anybody has had to come here and speak our mind on this. This was never put out to us in paper. It was not put on a ballot to vote on or anything like that. There's a lot of things that are happening today in New Carlisle that the citizens aren't being asked about. And that needs to stop. You need to enlighten the citizens. The other thing I have that I'd like to mention while I'm up here, I got 5 minutes.
Yeah.
You don't need Bell Manor. No for-profit company like they do is going to give away a building that they could be profitable and make a, you know, make income off of. Mm-hmm. I don't care what they say. This gentleman right here has pointed out some things tonight. And the two ladies that spoke earlier tonight, they had some real good facts that I haven't heard coming from the council. They had come from citizens. The other thing is, one last comment, and I'm going to sit down and let you answer my question. Waste management is a joke. Okay? I don't know how you can tell me, as a citizen of New Carlisle, that I have to have waste management pick up my trash. You don't pay for it. If the city paid for it, I'd understand. They completely screwed up the contract. They won't pick up stuff that's outside. There was a lady called, had to clean her garage out just down the street from me. She called waste management. She told them she was cleaning her garage out. She told them this stuff was going to be out there beside her can, and they told her they would pick it up. It sat there for 2 days. Mm-hmm. And that was on Adams Street. You know who I'm talking about, because I believe she called the city council. She talked to somebody. Waste management did come and pick it up.
Okay,
thank you very much.
Thank you.
I hope you look at this. Waste
management. Well, I was going to let Mr. Kitko touch on the cost of the coating and the other companies, if you don't mind.
Go ahead. There's two scenarios for how the tank can get painted. One is using an asset management where basically they take the cost and spread it over the, and with this case approximately 6 years, they spread the cost out, and then they drop that cost significantly with them risk, with their taking the risk. The other option is you hire a company, a tank painting company. They're similar, but they'll come in, you pay them the one lump sum, however you pay for it, the different funding scenarios. So if it costs $600,000, you pay them the $600,000, or they paint it, you pay them, and you get a 1 year warranty. After that, it is all falls back on the city of New Carlisle. Touch ups, any painting whatsoever. Paint coatings, as the gentleman said, they last anywhere from 10, 12, 15 years. Our current coating, from when it was put in 1985 till now, has held its coating. We're at the end of it. They don't make those lead-based coatings anymore. So there's pay once, 1 year warranty, and then it's all on the city for the next 12 to 14 years, 15 years. Or you look at an asset management. They're able to spread your payments over that approximately 6 years. And then they lower their payments extremely low from the 7th through the 10th year, and they'll repaint it again. All risk. Touch-ups, peeling, coatings, well, you name it, they have to take care of it at all for no additional cost to the city. That's just the two different types of the way the tank can be taken care of. How we fund that is to fund the actual annual amount. Those options we'll be bringing up here shortly.
So it's going to cost each citizen in New Carlisle over the next 3 years a 35% increase in their water bill for us to have someone come in and do the maintenance of the tank, like you said. And let's say you go with the company that's going to maintain it for 15 years. I want to know why we're going to be paying 35% increase in our water bills in the next 3 years. I believe it was put out as 20, 10, and 5, something like that.
That's what the current one is now, and we have a couple different funding options that are out there. The tank initial paint job right now is running about $600,000 to almost $700,000 to get it coated.
Okay. Can I interrupt you? And the water rate increases are not strictly 100% for this tower project.
We've had water increases the last 3 years.
As you should. I mean, every year you should see a small increase.
Why do we use any more water?
Because it still is a cost to maintain that. You got wages going up, you got cost of chemicals going up. I mean, the whole point of the enterprise fund is for it to be self-sufficient. So I understand your concern. Now, you had mentioned earlier up there that this didn't go in front of the voters for approval. I have never seen a water rate increase go in front of a voter for the voters to approve that or not. It's strictly a council decision. As far as waste management concerns, you live in a city. We have a city charter. All right. When you live in a city, you're going to have a lot more rules and regulations to where if you just go right outside the city limits and live in Bethel County. When you live in a city like this, you have voluntarily agreed to follow all the ordinances in place. The city has ordinances in place to say, hey, whoever we contract out with, now our people in our single family or double family homes has to go with that particular service provider as well. It's not something I didn't make the rule. These guys didn't make the rule. It's been on the books for a very long time. Now, yes, they will not pick up trash outside of your container anymore because, quite frankly, we've had a huge issue with trash in the city going everywhere except the trash container. Okay? You go up to Northwoods or anywhere in the city, there is blowing trash everywhere prior to us changing that trash agreement. Okay? Point one. Point two is it was blatantly against our own codes to put your trash out not in a container with lids. So the city was on its own violating its own rules and regulations with the last trash contract by allowing people to use yellow bags or put trash around the outside of the container. Animals get into it, wind blows it open. So what you're seeing now is a very solid waste management contract agreement. There has been some issues with pickup, but when you look at our total population of 6,000, we have such a small people who may not be happy with it. And I'm not saying this is you in particular, but if it's happened to me, I'll call. I get 15 phone calls from a citizen, and they have not had their trash picked up. So I pick up the phone, I call waste management. You know what the problem is? They pay the bill. You know, so use your own personal experience with waste management, not what other people are saying before you make a judgment. I'm not saying you did, but just in general. But another thing with this is too is what we have is a very aggressive pricing. You know, we've got three different selections for our citizens to choose from. Whether you're senior or older, you get a 13-gallon if you want for $9 a month. That's a steal. You can also go up to the middle size container and recycle. So what we have is we have different level options for whatever type of family you have. It's unfortunate that a lot of people just didn't really understand the new terms of the contract agreement. But what it did is it actually saved us money across the board. Council dropped the franchise fee, which would lower your bill. We had got a renewal even before the bag drama came out. Cost of the bags are going to shoot up. If we would have kept the contract the way it was, again, the price of the bags would have shot up. And then those who are on the flat rate service, we're going to pay for that increase because what happened was the last four-year contract the city had with the bags, we had people sharing bags. We had people going and sharing service. So the waste management lost some money. When we bid it out for this new year, how many people responded? Two. Waste management and Rumpke prices were significantly higher than waste management. So at the end of the day, it was change. That's what it was. Problem is, people didn't educate themselves on that change. We had put out flyers on our city Facebook page. Waste management had not out flyers indicating people to choose a new service level. They just did not do that. Again, same situation with the paying phone bill. Well, I didn't know this. Did you see the flyer that waste management said? No, let me go check my mail file. Oh, here it is. I guess it's my fault. I get people don't like change, but change is always necessary to get yourself in a better position than when you were before. If you don't change, you remain stagnant and stale, and then you have this. You don't see any kind of increases. You see this flat line that gets going across. So the waste management contract was a big change for the city, but I will stand 100% behind that. I submitted to the council. They approved it. I do believe it was passed 7-0. But don't quote me on that. But at the end of the day, it is a waste contract that is going to better align the city in the future and immediately because we see all that.
So what's to stop me from having a private hall?
Because it's against our codes. But what happens is, and this is why we fielded this question before, and it makes sense to whoever, it makes sense to everyone, but I guess when you do this for a living. Say for example, we allow everyone to choose their own service level. Okay, so you have waste management, you have Rocky, you have Allied, you have another guy who comes in to do it, you have somebody else. Now all of a sudden we have 50 million trash trucks on our streets. Streets are already bad enough. You know, then we got 50 million trash trucks in the alley. We have 50 million trash trucks coming at any day of the week. You know, well I know, because we changed that because if you notice the big divots in the alleys going on. So, yeah, again, nobody likes change, but these rules are in our policies and ordinances are in place because guess what? They've been tested, tried and true in other places and didn't work. You know, it's just a matter of, I think people get confused with rural living and city living, and they think if they came from this rural area, they can do the same thing in city limits, and it's a totally different game change. It's a totally different set of rules, and they're there because we're obviously packed in here together. So, yeah, I just think anytime there's change, people don't like it until they really embrace it. And I said this before council going to the waste management contract. You know, if they change my service level, it is what it is. You know, I can't really do anything about that. However, if they change the day of the week that they pick my garbage up on, I'm going to be livid. So one of the things we did try to change, was at least remain the same, was the day they picked up the trash. So if that's a positive, it's a positive. But, you know, the waste contract, it was a very, very stressful time for myself. I looked at probably 30 to 40 other cities. And that's why we have the contract that we have. And I've actually had other cities call me to ask me questions about how I came to our conclusion with our trash contract. Because quite frankly, it is a very solid across-the-board contract that hits all demographics. And that's what we're shooting for. Can I ask what size container you have?
I have a large one.
Do you use that large one every week?
No.
But you can go down to the third. Or you, now I'm not asking you on your age.
No, I can't.
Why?
Because when I mow my grass,
mm-hmm.
that's the only container I can put my yard waste in.
Mm-hmm.
Or I rake my leaves, that's the only container I can put my yard waste in.
Mm-hmm. So before you had
what? So I need the large can.
Oh, yes.
Before I had 2 30-gallon cans out there, and I could put my grass clippings on one of them, and waste management picked it up.
Sure.
No questions asked. I had a great guy picking up my trash.
Mm-hmm.
You know, the operator was fine. He was the truck driver.
Well, they are not determined to the
cover. So I have to get the larger can so I can maintain my home
mm-hmm.
to the standard that I want to keep it.
Mm-hmm.
Not, you know.
And how often do you do yard clippings? Maybe, what, a couple months?
Once a week.
Once a week? So yes. In January you cut grass?
No. Well, you know I don't. But I have put out my flower beds and I have raked out the leaves and I have done that kind of stuff and I'm almost filled up that can.
Have you looked at going down to the medium sized container and maybe rent an additional container for $250 a month?
Won't work.
Okay. Thank you.
All right. Thank you, sir. Next.
Hello, Matthew Mills. Welcome to 31 Gale again. A couple of questions regarding the water. I know I'm going to be 30 this month, not this month, this year. We've got 2 kids. I can afford a 35% increase. I can. How big deal is it? All people here sounds like they can. I agree with the gentleman in front of me. Thank you for your service. First, I have heard the 35% increase, whether that's accurate or not, is on social media. Wasn't a letter, wasn't a pamphlet. Social media, telling the water rates were going to raise. So I'm here. I'm here to find out the truth. I don't want to find out on social media, I want to find out from here. I also heard from the gentleman in front of me that if council decides to vote on this issue tonight, you do every citizen a huge disservice. Without first properly informing everyone of the decision that's going to be made. First off, the complete scope of work. The gentleman next to us detailed what he's going to do. Again, I'm going to use my professional experience here. If you're in the business of obtaining risk, there's a cost to obtaining risk. What is that cost? There must obviously be some cost differential between having a contractor come in, paint the inside and outside, versus having asset manager come in and assess the risk and take that on. There's got to be a cost differential. What is that? You know, taxpayers should know what that is. Also, I agree that, you know, what other avenues do we have besides raising the rate? If that's all we have, that's all we have. I understand that. But again, how can we vote on that when it's been a week since I first heard it. I don't know when everybody else has heard it. You know, just my opinion. I think that there's more vetting that needs to be done. Now, don't get me wrong. I don't want to be in Michigan. Water is one of the most important things we can have. We need to have safe water. We need to have reliable water. If you got to pay for it, you got to pay for it. But we need to understand what that cost is in a week and a half time. Second, in my opinion, now, it's like kicking the dead dog, what lies. Bell Manor. Everyone here, we need to have a better understanding why that's a good deal. I heard some council members say up there that we think it's a good deal, we think it's the right direction. Why? Somebody say why. It doesn't have to be here tonight, but somebody say why is it a good deal? We need to know that. I said my piece.
Thank you, sir. Anyone else?
Christine Walker, 410 West Jefferson. I'm really curious about what the council's goals are long term for the city, and it really plays into the water increase, it plays into Bell Manor, those sorts of things. What are those long term goals? And I think knowing that might help people understand, because it seems like little nitpicky things that people are getting upset about because this is their everyday. They're not seeing what that long term is, and so they're not seeing what that payoff is in the long run. Does that make sense?
Mm-hmm. Very much.
Yeah, I mean, if you're just, you're talking long goal for the city, correct?
Right,
I mean,
Right, I've heard that with Bell Manor, for example, it's the right direction to go, and if people have mentioned, like, why is that? And I've heard reasons for, you know, parts of it we can rent out, those such things, but I've also heard, and I've seen for myself, that it is an aging population, so what's the plan to get more people in, to get younger people, to get businesses in, who are going to help alleviate that cost? Because if the population is aging, the money that they have is going to drop. What they're going to be able to give to the city to help that happen is going to drop. So you need those younger professionals coming in that can help alleviate that and get to those long-term goals.
Okay. I mean, I think we've kind of covered... Yeah, I was saying, our long-term goals are kind of what we've kind of touched on here and there tonight. I mean, watching our budget as much as we can, keeping costs down, getting our budgets built, our general fund built up, taking care of our infrastructure so businesses want to move in our roads. I mean, roads are, roads is a really important part of town. Not the water isn't, but, some people just don't realize how expensive road repair is. I mean, for me, when you drive into town, that's the first thing I see, and it's like, God, we've got to get this stuff fixed, but it's just not so simple and easy to do it. We have our road levy fund that everyone was expecting would just start, covering all these new roads, and that fund only generates like $125,000 a year. But, you heard Mr. Kitko talking about earlier that the project on EdBook was almost $200,000. That's just one road. So, I mean, there's just all kinds of different aspects. I mean, we just, perception is everything. I think I've heard a couple of council members say that. We need to make sure that we make our city look as bright and as shiny as possible with what we have to do so to attract business. And we've got a lot of great churches, organizations, police department is, I think, doing a great job, fire department. So I think just kind of moving in that direction. I don't know if that's answered
well. It's attracting it because I live here, but I work over at LexisNexis. And the one thing that all my coworkers ask me is, why in the world did you make such a long drive? They don't see the benefit of making the drive to this location.
Right.
And so when you have people that, like you guys have said, people living here are working elsewhere. So when you're having New Carlisle taxing, which I've lived in more expensive places, so it doesn't hurt like affect me as much. I understand it, but I've lived in more expensive places, so I kind of, okay, it is what it is. But when you're getting taxed by New Carlisle, when you're getting taxed by Springfield, when you're getting taxed by Ohio, when you're getting taxed by the federal government, that doesn't leave a lot left. And so if nobody's working here, like, what are you trying to do to get that to happen, to help alleviate that? Because then if people living here feel like they're being nickel and dimed, and the people that are working elsewhere and living elsewhere, they're not seeing a reason to come here. Mm-hmm. And that's why I'm asking, what are you trying to do to get those people here?
Let me take that. Young professional, you nailed it right on the head, and that's exactly the problem. Why would you, as a young professional, I'm going to be very honest, and I hate to come across like this sometimes, but sometimes you got to roll up the sleeve and just say it how it is. Why would you, you're a young professional, okay, you're new to the area, I just got here from the base, I'm going around and looking at all these nice little towns. I got Bellbrook, I got Centerville,
I got, let's see what else is around. I got New Carlisle. Okay. Tip City. I come to New Carlisle, I drive around. Okay, well, it's really cheap to live here, 1.5%. Mm-hmm. That's very low. Yeah. Very low. Okay, I continue on driving around. That's a great little town. School. I do a little more research. Schools can't pass a level. I look around, I look at the city itself, I look at the city building, it's an old doctor station, I walk in, I'm cramped. Their image right off the bat is bad, okay? I go around a little more. What services do I have here at the city building? None. I want to bring my aging grandma to the senior citizen community. Oh, we don't have one. I want to take my dog to the dog park. We don't have one.
Right, and I agree, because
so there's a long-term plan. We need to make this city a real, legit city to where we have got places for our citizens to go. People who come into this want to stay. We don't have that. You know, we don't have that kind of let's grab them in here and attract them. When I interviewed for the planning director position, I knew nothing about New Carlisle. Not a darn thing. I was born and raised in Cincinnati. I went to college. Didn't know anything about it. A couple days before I interviewed, I got my car. I drove up here. I looked at the town. Thoroughly blown away, impressed. Wow, the downtown's huge. Wow, there's actually people walking around. My Lord, they have a cafe. Totally blew my mind. Blew it.
Right, and that's the thing, because I grew up in Texas. My mom is from, she grew up in Crystal Lake, so our family's here, but I grew up in Texas. So for me, driving 40 minutes is absolutely nothing. Me having to drive 20 minutes to, you know, go to Lowe's or something, that's nothing, because I grew up in Texas. But when people are from smaller states like this, that 20 minutes is a big difference. That 40 minutes, that they're like, I would be home by now. And for me, what got me here was I have family in the area, and I could buy a house cheaper than I could rent an apartment or anything else and still have my pets and all of that. Mm-hmm. But that's because I had family here and I know about that. If I didn't have that family as a young professional, I wouldn't even think to look. And I'd get asked, where in the world is that? And I have to explain how I drive home. You're like, really? That seems so far. But it means it's not.
And it's a ripple effect. And I feel bad every single time I say it, because you know what? I don't work. I don't live in the city. But I pay the full 1.5% as if I do. It is a very low income tax rate. And you got to understand, prior to the police levy passing, it was only 1%.
Oh, yeah, okay? I just live in D.C. They
so it's just like, I think most people think, they think, oh, I pay my 1.5%, and that should be good enough. But then they don't realize the ripple effect that comes out of that 1.5% and the services that you get. How much you pay in your income tax directly results of what kind of city you're going to live in. Let's just be honest. That's just how it works. So we are doing literally the best with what we got. I mean, you just heard our budget presentation.
Oh, yeah.
We withheld spending by $600,000. And we only have a 1.5% income tax rate. I'll be honest with you. The whole reason why we're in the position with the water stuff is because years ago, they built a plant of size that they didn't even need. We are the ones paying $210,000 a year on it.
Yeah.
So again, it's not a misadministration of money. It's not the water rate increase is not because of we haven't done anything wrong. It's a result of a series of bad decisions that got us to where we are.
And I think it's maybe because I didn't grow up around here that I do have that different perspective. I do understand that. But I think it just wasn't clear. I actually, because I haven't previously been able to make the meetings, I've been watching them online at least to get information. So I did know 2 weeks ago about the water, but that I think it's just people not understanding that long-term effect. And don't get me wrong, nostalgia is great. And that's one of the reasons I like the town, is because it does have some of that stuff from the past. But I think through people fearing change, that fear could keep us from making that progress and unfortunately not having anything to sustain the city. So that's just really my concern.
I agree with you 110%, and thank you so much for getting on the podium and saying what you said.
Thank you, ma'am. I'm not gonna squeeze you too tight. Let's try and keep it going, because it's getting really late.
Oh, come on now.
No, go ahead. I'm just saying. Let's not make it 20 minutes.
I'm gonna fix it.
June 5 Waver, 6 Pine Street. I'm gonna make it real short. Kind of getting along with what this gentleman said. I went and looked on the census page, and I also went and looked on the Social Security page, just for a little information. According to the census, the last census, and of course that's been a while, but we have 15.4% of our population at or below poverty level in this town. They probably cannot afford a 35% increase in their water bill. We have, 14% of the people in this town are either a single household or retired and on a fixed income, which comes back to, can they afford a 35% increase? According to the Social Security website, the average paycheck for someone living on Social Security per month is $1,360. We need to take all that into consideration when we talk about increasing our water bill.
Thank you very much, ma'am. Anyone else from the audience? Okay.
Mr. Mayor,
oh, sorry, sir.
My name is Mark Moeller, and I live at 506 North Washington Street, and I want to thank the members of council. I know you worked hard. There's no question. Mr. Bridge, I want to congratulate you on what you and your staff have done to reduce spending. If you don't mind, I'll give you a little tip. These people are coming here with concerns. This is their town. Their family lives here. It's not personal to you. Mm-hmm. So please feel free not to get defensive when people share their concerns. We all love this town. A ton. We want to live here. But my heart breaks when I hear people talking about being on fixed income. And I hear people talking about our poverty level. And again, nothing is communicated to these people. This 35% increase is going to be voted on. You go to the New Carlisle page, and what you do see is, hey, there's a petition going around about reciprocity, nothing about the increase. Nothing there. You can't just throw a 35% increase on these people. You're a smart guy. You are smart people. Figure out something else. We got to pay for it. We got to pay for it. But there's more than one way. Ethan's brought up some ideas. And you better investigate them. And what these people are saying about doing it this quick is right. You better take your time. That thing's been 30 years. You can wait another 30 days to make a decision. And as far as Bell Manor, it's interesting to me. I've operated chains of stores. And I've taken over buildings and moved from one place to another. And to hear that there's not going to be any rehab costs is ridiculous. If nothing else, you're going to have moving expenses. If nothing else, you're going to have to rewire for internet. If nothing, and you even mentioned, we want to make sure that we inspect for asbestos in case we need to rip up tile and put down carpet. That's rehab. That has a cost. And the cost that you're going to have to put into this building to make it suitable, I'm telling you right now, are higher than you think they're going to be. And you better take it into consideration. I don't know if it's a good idea or a bad idea. To me, it's a bad idea. But I don't know if you've done your due diligence. And maybe you have. I don't know. But when I hear that there's not going to be any rehab, I know from doing this kind of thing that that's not a true statement. That's all I've got.
Thank you, sir. Thank you. Appreciate it. Ma'am?
Hi, I'm Becky McKenzie. I'm at 521 Hamilton.
I'm sorry. Can you say your name one more time?
Becky McKenzie.
Thank you.
Probably one of the first council meetings I've been to, but I grew up in New Carlisle, and I've always liked living here, and I think that over the past maybe 10 years, our community hasn't taken responsibility for itself. And when there's talk about this reciprocity and how that's what our income is, that's what pays these people, that's what pays our bills. And then I hear about taking money out of the general fund to pay for the water tower, but we need that backup money. We need that. We also can't really afford to pay 35% increase, so we need another way. I think that what people need to hear is that you're understanding their their abilities and what and the money that they don't have. They need to hear that from you. They need to hear that. We need to hear that you're trying to look for other opportunities. As far as Bell Manor, that could be a great thing for us. It could be great for our community. We should have a community center, but you need to tell everybody that. We need to show them what they can have. If you want people to get behind you and what you want to do, you have to show them and you have to motivate them. You can't just tell them facts. You can't tell them that because they don't care and they might not believe you. You have to show them. That's the only way that they're going to go behind you in any of this.
Thank you, Becky.
Thank you very
Thank
much.
You.
I want to speak on your on council's behalf. Becky, I will share this. Council, behind the scenes over the last couple weeks, have been doing a lot of discussion and work related to how this was going to be shared with the public. And the reason that this ordinance was actually moved to the town hall portion of this meeting was to allow this forum. Right. So I just want everybody to understand that council is doing what they can to make sure the information gets out there.
I think they're doing what they can to get the information out there, but I think our city, the people that live there, are giving up. There's a lot of complaining.
I would agree with that.
Bitching and moaning, but nobody's talking to each other about what Michael. Would really be good for the city. We get that we have to change this somehow. We just want to hear what you're saying.
Mr. Lowry.
Yeah, I would first, I want to make a motion, but before I do, I have something I want to say. This young lady that just spoke made me realize something. A while back, and I'm not good on the dates, we sat here and we talked, and what did we do? We needed money for a police levy. Okay? What did we all do? We passed flyers. We called people. Talk to everybody. Put signs in our yards because we wanted something. Okay? We wanted your money to pay for the police. Good thing, don't misunderstand me. I'm not saying it was bad. I think it was well worth it. But now here we are. We want to take away. We need the water. I want to drink fresh water. I don't want to put a cooler in my house and all the bottles and stuff. I still got to bathe in it. And I think water, as the gentleman over here said, is very, very important. But we didn't do it right. Not a one of us. I'm talking about myself. We did this in a 4-week period. We never talked to anybody. We talked in here when there was no one here. Okay? We didn't hide. Okay? Don't misunderstand. We didn't hide. No one comes to city council meetings. I can't change that. Only you can change that. Okay? But we should have been, went about it in a different way. Another thing, this gentleman, nothing against you, sir, for standing up. I appreciate you talking about your business, but I bet you there's another business out there that does the same thing you do. I think we need to explore it. With that being said, I want to make a motion to table Ordinance 17-05 until we investigate further. I would even like to see if we can come up with a committee from people out here to research this and look at it and see what we can come up with. So I officially make a motion to table Ordinance 17-05 for at least 45 days.
Okay, before you guys go any further, and I don't think any member of council has mentioned this, there is an ordinance for review today at 2010-05. Okay, but has anyone failed to communicate with you? There's actually 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 ways to debate this. Council tonight is going to look at these debate them. So it's not just one option that's in front of us. Do you think? I know I'm very tough with my words. It's not defensive, it's factual. And when you do this for a living, you kind of have to give the facts. Some people present them as facts, some people present them in other ways. But I do appreciate you getting up there and saying that. That takes a lot of courage. This is a tough call for council. I mean, it truly, truly is. But I don't want your citizens to think that you guys just have this 2010-05 thing in front of you, that you guys have not asked for research. I've made graphs. You know, they have all kinds of stuff in front of them to make a decision. I didn't think they would come to a conclusion tonight about water rates. I really did not. I think they would take a look at all this information they have in front of them, take opinions from who's in the audience, and then come back at a later date and decide what is the best option for the city. I would not want to be in one of their seven shoes. I mean, that is a very tough position to be in. This side of it, our job is to feed them the information. It is their job to decide what they want to do next. It is a tough, tough call. We have a situation here to where, because of the past 30 years, these have not been maintained. Let's just get to the bottom of it. That's why we're here. They have not been maintained the past 30 years. We have to know we have to deal with it. I would not be doing my job. If you brought this to my attention, I said I would worry about it. This is your drinking water when it comes down to it. 30, 20, 10, and 5 on the tongue of it was a very abrasive, hard increase. We have a chart here, and I really wish people would take a look at it. It puts the raises in perspective of dollars. You know, it's still an increase. I don't like when I have to pay more for this. But at the end of the day, I think that this was a heck of a first step. I have seen more people in this audience tonight than in the 5 years that I've worked for this city.
Amen.
You know, and that's the whole point of how government and their citizens should work. You guys should be here. You should give them an earful. They tell us what to do. And tonight was an example of how this is supposed to work, whether it be controversy about Bell Manor, about the water increases. You're never going to have appease everyone. There's always going to be someone who doesn't think it's the best path to choose. And I tell these guys all the time, vote on what you know and not what people tell you to do or think, because they're the ones who know the ins and outs. You know, some people might get information wrong they see on the internet. So they have one of the toughest jobs right now to decide what is the best track to do. And I don't envy that decision. They have all the information in front of them. If they table it tonight, I probably think that would be a good idea. You know, it truly probably would. I was going to also recommend another scenario where, you know, if you're going to take any money out of the general fund, which we do need to protect that fund, 17 is the year to do it. Mm-hmm. So take that first payment, 115, out of it. It had to increase across the rest of the board. But we have so much that we don't know about that's coming up next year. I had told a couple of them, pass it, if anything, pass it tonight with a small 5% increase. That would get us by 17. Mm-hmm. We'll know eventually here enough if that tax credit petition is going to pass. If that tax credit petition passes, we're going to have a slew of other problems we have to deal with. But if it fails, then we'll have a much better understanding of what our general fund is going to look like and how much that can piggyback and help off at this time project. So, again, very tough scenario. They have got a mound of data in front of them, and they've had it for the past week. Tough call. Very good first step, even though we are agreeing to disagree. This is how it works, and this is how it happens, you know? You get up there and you say things that you truly, truly believe in, and that's where we're at today. So, as far as I'm concerned, this is probably one of the best council meetings that I've ever been in for the city. Everything coated in sugar, but this is why I got into what I do. It's working out a problem.
Sorry. Okay, Gene, we got a motion on the table. You were gone at the time, so.
What's the motion?
I made a motion to table ordinance -17-054 at least 45 days.
Was it second? Do you want to table it, or you just want to let it die to a lack of?
No, I want to table it.
So what's your second back to that motion?
Okay, hang on.
Let me read it first. I have to read it first, and you can make your motion.
Okay.
Let me read it first. Oh, man, I forgot where I'm at. We've been here for so long. Ordinance 17-05, an ordinance amending section 104.3.05 of the codified ordinances of the City of New Carlisle regarding charges for the use of the municipal water supply. Now, sir.
Mr. Mayor.
Give something, sir.
Oh, Mr. Lauer, I'm sorry.
Motion to table ordinance 17-05 for at least 45 days.
I'm going to second that, but I don't know why you come up with 45 days. I'll second it.
Hang on, man.
Hey.
Okay, I have a motion to table ordinance 1705 for a period of 45 days. I have a motion by Mr. Rick Lauer and a second by Mr. Krabacher. Discussion. Mayor Lowry.
No.
Mr. Reynolds.
No.
Mr. Lindsay.
No.
Mr. Leidy.
No.
Mr. Rick Lowry.
Yes.
Mr. Lethley.
No.
Mr. Krabacher.
Yes.
Motion to table fails 2-5.
Mr. Mayor.
Yes.
I make the motion we accept order 17-05.
Second. Hang on just a minute, please. Is that second by you, Mr. Reynolds?
Mr. Leidy.
I have a motion by Mr. Lindsay, a second by Mr. Leidy. Discussion?
So this is the...
motion to actually vote on the actual ordinance.
Mm-hmm.
The 2010-5.
Is this... Okay. Can we ask a question?
Yes.
Is this for the 2010-5 then? Is that what's on
this
the
is for what's in front of you. This is for right here. This is for right here.
Yeah, so is that on the ordinance?
It's for the ordinance that's before us.
But it's the charges on that ordinance. Because we were supposed to make a decision on the charges.
Yeah, it's on the...
This is on the 2010-5.
This is to discuss the current rates. Yeah. Motion, we have to have a motion to discuss the current rates.
Okay.
Right. Regardless of how we feel about what the rates are, we have to have a motion to discuss the rates.
Right. Okay.
Whether it be the 35 with the 2010-5 or the 35 with 10-10-5-5, and we have to have the motion to discuss it.
Okay.
All right.
I just want to make sure everybody's clear.
That's the intent of your motion, yeah. Just to make that discussion.
Yes.
Okay.
To discuss any business regarding water rates, we have to have the motion before us. Well, I'm just making sure to explain to them, not to you, obviously. You've done this for quite a while, but to the people, you have to have a motion to discuss it, to actually figure out what's going on and talk about it and actually have good, honest conversation instead of saying, oh, let's table it and discuss it in 45 days. But this is the way we can talk about it now, know what's going on now, so you can go home and talk to your friends and family members and let them know what's happening.
Okay.
And Mr. Mayor.
Mr. Lindsay.
And to follow up with Mr. Reynolds, it will give you time to go home and discuss with your family members, friends, relatives, people you know in town, and then come back in 2 weeks and let us know what you decide to do.
But we're going to vote on it.
But to discuss anything, we have to have a motion to discuss anything. We can't just, if that was the case, then we'd break every meeting and say, oh, we're going to talk about...
Well, discuss it then.
That's what we're giving. I have to explain to them because they're confused, not you, Gene.
But the ordinance has already the rates into it.
Yes, and we're going to vote yes or no.
So we vote yes or no.
Yeah, you're going to vote yes or no.
On the ordinance.
So if it goes through, then it's going to be the high.
If it goes through, that's up to you guys to choose because
it's the high end.
Okay. Council, discussion on this ordinance.
I would like to start.
Well, you want to go down the line, or do you just want to?
Want to discuss it?
Yes.
Yes, let's discuss it.
Okay. Well, do you want to just go down the line?
Yeah.
Okay, Mr. White.
I think we gotta come up with a different plan. I mean, your voices have been heard. Unfortunately, the saying's been said tonight, the best bad option, and we have four options, and none of them, I feel, fit the city well enough. So that's how I feel on
it.
If I understand Mr. Lighty correctly, the four options he's referring to is the rate increases, the four options on rate increases we have before us. On this here, I do not know if the citizens has a copy of that or not. One of the rate increases is a 10, 10, 10, and 5. That's over a four-year period. One is 15, 10, 5, and 5, again, four-year period. The third option is 10, 10, 5, 5, and then the original at 20, 10, and 5. There's other options I believe we have also. As Mr. Grinch stated earlier, we can take the 115, correct me if I misunderstood you, that we could take the 115 this year, that would take care of 17, and then we would absolutely have to do something next year. And the reason that I say it that way, there's so many unknown variables right now that if we lose our 1.5% income tax rate, the city would probably just about be done, in my opinion. So next year, the general fund would not be able to handle the $115,000 layout for the water tower maintenance and infrastructure and stuff. Because that rate goes for more than just that water tower. I think we should do the 115. I don't know what the rest of the council thinks. I'm going to stop right there, Mr. Reynolds.
Mr. Lindsay, you talking about the 115 gift loan from the general fund?
I'm talking about the general fund. My understanding is the general fund can give $115,000 to the water. Yes.
Okay.
To give a gift to the water department, so we do not have to pay that money back to the general fund. I don't know, and I'm sure nobody sitting up here or out there knows if we will be able to do that 115 again next year. It would be awesome if we could, that our city would grow so much and we'd have so much income coming in that the general fund could give the water plant $115,000 for the next 6 years. That would be awesome, and we wouldn't have to raise our rates. I don't know if that would happen or not. I yield to Mr. Reynolds.
I think everyone knows my position on this. There's no way I'm voting for the rate increase at 35%. It's not going to happen. Sure as I'm sitting here. As Bill had mentioned, there's different ways we can do it. At the first budget meeting, I said, let's see if we can loan. At the time, we thought that we didn't know if we could give the money or not. So I said, let's loan the money from the general fund to it. But I brought up in the next meeting that we found we could gift the money. So I said, let's gift the money to the general fund. We don't even know what our financing options are yet. We don't know if we're going to get approved for the loans. I mean, there's multiple options out here. I don't think they've all been explored. I think that's what we need to do for the next 45 days or so, and explore those options. And we're allowed to gift the money, so I honestly think that that general fund surplus, I know some people don't call it a surplus, but if you have extra money padded in there, it's surplus. Call a pig a pig.
But don't let it live in the city.
Unless you petition to do it. Call a pig a pig. So, I think we should do it. I think I'm going to yield now because I don't think I'm ever get better than that. So. Go ahead.
I don't have any handle jokes. Echo. I don't like these increases. It's way too drastic. I mean, just like you guys do, my family lives here. I'm going to have to pay that water rate, and I don't want to pay that drastic increase. I know that there's other things that we need to look into. I do worry about taking money from the general fund because, and I'm not saying that's not the wrong way to go. I just be very cautiously. I mean, that general fund could be our savior at some point if we were to have some sort of horrible disaster or we need to drill a new water well or whatever it may be. I would like to look at my, personally, is just cleaning the inside of the tank. I don't know what that costs. I really, at this point, I'm not saying that I don't care about the tower in general as a whole, but as long as the water is clean, I don't really care what the outside of the tower looks like at this point. I mean, that may sound bad, but as long as it's clean and you're getting clean, filtered, fresh water, I mean, that may probably not make the best sense to the water techs back there and whatnot, but I would like to just see what it would take to get the inside of the tower clean and then move forward cautiously, but that's just my take.
I don't like that rate increase. I didn't like it when you first presented. As you well know, I threw just other numbers out there. I think it was 10, 10 something, 10, 10, 10, I think it was. So I didn't. I don't like that at all, and I wanted the other options too, and we got a whole big packet of options, a lot of numbers.
You ask, you shall receive.
That's right. That's right. Be careful what you pray for, that's for sure.
There you go.
I just want to ask the gentleman back there. We talked about, Mike was talking about the outside of the tank, and he said that he didn't care what the outside of the tank looked like, but you were kind of like looking away and what does outside of the tank make a difference?
The outside of the tank does make a difference. So if you have a sanitary survey from your EPA, one of the first things they'll do is comment on the exterior conditions of the tank. The next thing you have is, like I said earlier, you're at the end of that useful life. So if you ignore that, it's not going to get any cheaper because then you're going to have to blast it. And since you have high levels of lead on there, that cost is just is crazy. So they're designed to be painted over certain time frames, and you're at the end of that time frame, and by waiting longer, it does not get any cheaper. Mm-hmm. So you're kind of at the end, so you're gonna have to choose which direction to go. It is very much an aesthetic situation in some cases, so I'm not gonna argue that. Sometimes the tank is being protected very, very well, but it doesn't look good. In your case, you're on the edge of steel loss because of some areas on there, and you're at the edge of that epoxy starting to not have the adhesion that it needs to be able to paint over it. So I understand that it's expensive. Trust me, I understand that. But waiting in this case, it isn't going to get any cheaper. It's only going to get that much more expensive.
Yeah.
That makes sense?
But according to your statistics, we have, and according to the figures that we've got, we probably wouldn't be painting it till year three.
We're saying the exterior was year one.
Yeah,
exterior
would be
this year? Next year?
Mm-hmm.
Inside was 3 years. Oh,
yeah, inside was year three.
Inside was year four.
Okay. Yeah. All right. Well, you wanted to ask?
Just one quick question. I've heard you kind of brush on this a little
bit. Sure.
You're telling me you can't give us any better ballpark idea and then soon. You can't say 6 months, you can't say a year, not, I mean, you can't, as long as your company has done this, you can't give it any better answer than that.
If you can tell me what the weather conditions are going to be like in June, July, August, and what the temperatures are, and you know, you're headed to, I'm just trying to we know
it's way today, it'll change.
But the challenge is you don't know because you're just not sure of what those conditions are going to look like.
Right.
And when that urethane coating is gone on the exterior and all that epoxy becomes exposed, it is not like UV rays at all.
Okay.
So if we have one of those hot, hot summers, then we're sitting around and you're like, what to do? Mr. Mills here was talking about risk management earlier, which is a good concept. For me to sit here and say, hey, it can wait until spring of next year, and then spring of next year comes around and it can't, then that's a challenge. You also made a very good point about preventative maintenance and those kind of things. And I'm glad you mentioned that because AWWA shows, EPA shows, just about every statistic out there shows that preventative maintenance is a lot cheaper in the long term. Mm-hmm. And that's why we have thousands of tanks under these programs, because it's not just a risk management piece, it's preventative maintenance. So it shows every time it's more economical in the long haul. It's never fun on the front end because you're to that edge of point of failure now. You have to pay to get it back where it needs to be. But once it's there, in A-plus conditions, it's a whole lot cheaper to maintain that than it is to let it run a failure. But it's more economical in the long
haul.
All you have to do is look at this one chart that we were given that says if we don't increase the rate at all, what's going to happen?
No, that's with a 5% increase. You get 5 cents.
Five, yeah. We're in a negative $120,000 in 1 year. It's a usage situation. First of all, I want to make sure everybody understands it's not a 35% increase.
More.
It's more. Because when you increase and then increase on top of the increase, it gets progressively higher.
38 is
the 10-10-10-5 becomes 39.7%. The 15-10-5-5 is 39.4. 10-10-5-5 is 33.4. And 20-10-5 is 38.6 over 3 years instead of four. At the same time, it sounds awful, and I don't want to minimize this at all. But I took my bill over the past 12 months and I looked at what is my actual water usage. And under the 10-10-5-5, from beginning to end, it will increase a total amount of $97.20 a year for me. Family of two, okay?
What's that divided by 12?
That is $8.10 a month, 26.6 cents a day. Okay, so I understand fixed incomes. Believe me, in my line of work, I understand fixed income. For 25 cents a day to protect what we've got, and if you don't have the 25 cents today, I understand it's a lot of money. But it sounds worse than reality, too. But it's also a big increase. So that being said, I'm against it. But we have to, I think if we just sit back and not do anything regarding painting the thing, we're going to be in trouble because we know it's going to cost an extra $250,000. And how are you going to go back to them and say, oh, we screwed up, it's going to cost you another $250,000? I think that's irresponsible. But we have to be responsible with what we can do at the same time. I applaud Ethan's thoughts on, I think we use the general fund money. I think we go ahead with another 5% increase because we need to be building this up. And 5%, you're talking about 5 cents a day, okay? 5 cents a day at 5%. $1.58 a month, $18.40 a year. Not a lot of money. Five cents can protect a lot, okay? So that's my thoughts.
Good job.
We're not done yet.
No, sorry.
No, I'm done. I said everything okay. I had to say. I'm not going to do 35%.
No,
that's
no,
all
no,
no,
I am.
Oh, okay.
I
am. All right.
I have a question. Before we decide if we're going to take care of the outside or the inside, I want to know if our water is going to be safe for the next 3 years before we clean the inside. Is there anybody that knows the answer to that?
You have your water guy.
Yeah, well, the water superintendent's sitting here, but we test every day for water quality, okay? The inside of the tank looks great. If they were to take over this agreement and do the outside, and if year two we start getting some hits on water that's saying, hey, you know, you got some questionable stuff, they'll come right in and we'll drain the tank and get the inside done, if that's the reason for it. But yeah, we test every day, or at least 6 chlorine samples a month for bacteria, or 6 bacteria samples a month. So we know every month what's going on. But like I said, if something starts to hit and it's leading to the inside of that tank, then we're immediately going to call him. He's going to go, okay, we've got to get it on schedule. Boom, it's going to get painted.
What's that?
One more thing I'd like to add, and everybody's talking about scenarios, not everything's been looked at. This is an O&M project. I have looked at OPWC grants, I've looked at federal grants, I've looked at state grants. There are no grants for maintaining. There is a grant if I want to put a new $20 million tank up there, if I want to replace it, but that's obviously not going to happen. Rehabilitation, there's a very small amount, but only part of rehabilitation is $40,000. I might get $5,000. But there are no grants for just doing maintenance. So the only way you have is funding it in-house of some sort, somehow, whether that be loan, usage rates, inside. We have to fund it one way or another.
And I will add, you did look at the EPA loan that Mr. Kicker applied for. That would add $90,000 of interest and extra payments that were unpaid because we loaned it out.
Right.
So that's another pitch. Bump
in the road.
Bump in the road. The council would have to kind of derail and go through the pros and cons. But if they do an EPA loan, that's going to add additional money on the cost of time.
Can I make one qualification on what I was saying? When I talk about 5% increase, would only be about 5 cents a day. Please make if this goes through and we do an increase like that, and your bill goes up more than 5 cents a day. I'm talking about my cost for a family of two. Family of four, double that. Family of six, triple that. You know, so you know, 10 cents, 15 cents a day.
If you got more
than roughly, okay? And I don't shower off. No, I do.
And if you go to 5% for 17 only, that will give council time to look at how that tax credit petition plays out in November.
Exactly. That's the big,
and that's
big,
that's good.
Scary deal.
Recommend, because I don't like the risk we're taking, because the moment that outside cover goes, you're going to add $250,000 on that. you know, so there's money associated with risk. So that would
I think you have to put it in this ordinance, risk, right?
But I think we have to pass that in another period. And we're going to
tax that was the discussion. They'll submit it to us. They'll submit each of our ideas to us.
Okay, so
just one more thing, and I have been paying close attention to this. Well, it hasn't really come out all the way as that infrastructure bill. If the federal infrastructure bill comes out, water and wastewater plants are, I wouldn't call them dead last on that list, but they are near. They want roads, bridges done first. Because if you've seen the last article or the last news thing, 75-year-old plant, the guy cannot even get state funding to replace a wellhead that he's got there that is, he was down there plucking rust off the main line. And so what they're saying is this infrastructure bill will be come out to what do people see? What do you see first? Roads and bridges.
Roads and bridges.
They don't think about the water and wastewater industry. That is your priority. So that's down the road. This ain't going to help this particular situation, but obviously I've got four wells. I've got two that are outside of isolation radius. Those will need to be re-drilled soon. How soon? 5 years? 3 years? 8 years? But we got to be prepared.
Right.
So it's out there. So we got people here that know about this stuff. So I'm just putting it out there. We do have that coming up also.
Yeah.
Thank you, Mr. Kitko. Also, you know, Randy, Howie, everyone, I don't think anyone, don't take that personally. We don't think you're not doing a job. We're doing what they want us to do, which is ultimately the goal that we need to do. And we need to make sure we look at it. We lift everything and look under everything and look in every corner for every single option available for you guys, for the entire city. So, that's just what it boils down to.
And that's exactly how you guys should be handling this situation. Exactly how it's going down right now. So hats off to you, sir.
Comments to what we've talked about?
Yes. Because it's almost tomorrow.
Yeah,
it is almost tomorrow. Well, I think a lot of people thought that we were instantly going to do this right off the bat.
Well, that's the information that we got. Is the only thing that we heard was 2010-5 or taking money from the general fund. So hearing all the discussion of all the other options that you have to choose from is important for us to hear, to know that you're looking into this.
Of course.
Thank you,
Becky. Okay, any other discussion?
Yeah, what happens next?
We have to vote. We have to vote on the original ordinance.
Okay, what is it? Let me look.
But then in that it says that hereby the charge is established as such.
Absolutely.
That's what I said before.
Absolutely.
So we vote no on the ordinance.
Yep.
And we modify it.
And then they'll
come back with the modifications.
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
Okay.
We'll fail.
Good enough.
Call for the vote.
Don't break.
All right. Let's catch our breath. You ready?
Yeah.
All right.
Oh, well, I can't tell you how to vote.
I understand.
Promise me after this vote we can go home, right?
Yes. I want to understand the vote. I want to understand my vote.
Okay.
Am I understanding correctly?
Yes.
Okay.
Mr. Rick Lowry.
No.
No. Mr. Lethley.
No.
Mr. Craybaugh.
No.
Mayor Lowry.
No.
Mr. Reynolds.
No.
Mr. Lindsay.
No.
Mr. Lighty.
No.
17-05 fell 0-7.
Mr. Mayor, may I have it?
Hey, Mr. Wade, before you guys leave, thank you for coming tonight.
Thank you.
Mr. Lindsay, go ahead.
I just want to thank everybody who came out tonight. The only way that this city is going, that we can do our jobs up here, is to have you people out there telling us what you want. The only way you're really going to get the information is to come to these council meetings. I know they're a pain. A lot of them are boring.
And they're normally not this long.
And they're normally not this long. They're usually only an hour, hour and a half at the most.
At the most.
We really do need your input, and I do not believe in going to Facebook and saying, hey, can you come to our meeting? I put it out there regularly, but we're having a council meeting.
Yeah, he just said it.
So I thank all of you together, collectively, individually. Thank you on YouTube for listening. But we need the input of the citizens so we can make the best decisions for this city. Thank you.
Mr. Mayor, I move we adjourn.
Second.
Thank you.